a sellout crowd, and it will be rocking tonight. The Cleveland Browns and the Houston Oilers, a key matchup in the Central Division of the AFC. Hello again, everyone. I'm Frank Gifford, and we are glad you're with us on this election eve. We think we have a fine football game to bring to you tonight. Very important game for both of these ball clubs. The winner tonight will stay within one game of the Cincinnati Bengals in the Central Division of the AFC. The loser will drop two back, and there are only six games remaining on the season for them. Both of these teams are on a bit of a roll. The Cleveland Browns have won three in a row coming into tonight. They have Bernie Kosar back and healthy at quarterback, making his third start. He's never lost to the Houston Oilers. He's 5-0. Meanwhile, the Houston Oilers, they feel they have finally come together. They feel that under Warren Moon, who was also out for several weeks, they are back together, and they proved that, at least to themselves, last week against Washington. They beat them 41-17 on this very same field. They are looking to break a long string of losses to the Cleveland Browns. And I would say, Al, that both of these teams actually feel like they are where they would have liked to be at the start of this season.
I barely recognize you, by the way, without your mask. Indy,
I was going to wear yours.
You're right. You're exactly right about both teams being very, very happy coming off big victories. Now, as far as the Oilers are concerned, this is a team that's developed a reputation. They will hit you. They will hit you very hard. And in the estimation of people like Chuck Noll at Pittsburgh, they will hit you very late. They lead the league in penalties. They lead the league in penalty yardage. But that tends to obscure the fact they have some extremely talented players. Mike Rozier has developed into one of the top running backs in the National Football League. Alan Pinkett has come along as well at the running back position. And they have a terrific tandem of wide receivers in Drew Hill, who had a sensational night against Washington, and Ernest Givens. And they have Warren Moon back. So this team can score a lot of points. But can they score against the tremendous Cleveland defense? And Dan, a lot of people thought the Cleveland Browns would represent the AFC in the Super Bowl come January in Miami. What do you think of their chances right now?
Well, it would be a disservice, I think, to both Cincinnati and Buffalo to say that the Cleveland Browns are the favorite to go to the Super Bowl from the AFC. But really, now that Bernie Kosar is back, not much has changed as far as the quality of this football team. And maybe too much is made about Bernie being back, because that's talking offense. And when you talk Cleveland Browns, you really have to talk about their defensive team, because they haven't had a lot of offensive help. Coming into this weekend, only Kansas City and Detroit have scored fewer touchdowns than the Cleveland offense. So what has to happen? You have to play good defense, and boy, have the Browns responded, because their defensive team has allowed the fewest number of touchdowns in the NFL. Now, the Houston Oilers like to call the Astrodome the House of Pain. They think they're the hardest-hitting team in the league. But if you're a member of the Cleveland Browns, who have won seven out of the last eight games against the Oilers, until they beat you, it's just talk.
And so the Browns and the Oilers, in what figures to be a very hard-hitting game, a good defensive struggle, and a most important game, obviously, in the AFC Central. And the Oilers will receive, kicking off, the Cleveland Browns. And for the Browns, Matt Barr, who's having a sensational season, will put it in the air as Houston will take possession, coming off their 41-17 victory last week against the Super Bowl champion Redskins. Leonard Harris, in his third year out of Texas Tech, awaits the kick at the goal line. Crowd on its feet at the Astrodome, and here we go as Barr puts it in the air, and Harris moves over to take it at the 7-yard line. Past the 20, and he breaks it back out to the 29-yard line. A fumble, but after he was down. So Houston with the ball, and here is Warren Moon. Six great years in the Canadian Football League with Edmonton, and then he shocked himself prior to the 1984 season, looked at several NFL teams, and opted at that point to come here because Hugh Campbell, his Canadian coach, was coaching the Oilers at the time. Rozier and Highsmith in the backfield. We talked about Hill and Givens a moment ago. Jamie Williams is the tight end. He's a good blocker, doesn't catch very many balls. And three of those men, Munchak, Steinkuhler, and Matthews, were first-round draft picks. From the 31-yard line, Rozier wrapped up by Mike Johnson after he picks up four.
the Heisman Trophy winner out of Nebraska in 1983, who spent 2 years in the USFL, then came here. Clancy Golic and Big Daddy Carl Hairston, 14th season. The three-man front, Grayson as fast as they come as a linebacker, Mike Johnson and Eddie Johnson, with Clay Matthews on the outside facing his brother Bruce across the line. The best pair of corners in the league, Minifield and Dixon. The rookie Brian Washington and Felix Wright are the safeties. Second and six. Oilers from the 35-yard line. They keep it on the ground, and Rozier fights his way for a first down. It's a team with two great receivers, but also, I think, an underrated running game, especially this year, and Rozier has spearheaded that.
A lot of people think the Oilers might have the best set of running backs in the league. When I talk about set, I'm talking about all five of these guys. Mike Rozier, Alonzo Highsmith, Spencer Tillman, Alan Pinkett, and Lorenzo White. They are talented and they are very, very deep.
Well, you can't beat them for Billboard. Jerry Glanville, the man in black, in his customary garb tonight. His Oilers at the 44 with the game's first down. And Moon, on a delay, gives it to Alonzo Highsmith, another of that great bevy of running backs. He was their number one pick out of Miami last year. Held out, came on late in the season, and right now he's backing up, I don't want to say Rozier. He normally plays in the two-back set, but they use Rozier and they use Pinkett a lot with Highsmith in tandem.
Big game last week against Washington, his best thus far, 75 yards. But we're watching the Cleveland Browns defense, which is number two overall. They were through nine games, but they were only 20th against the run. And this is what Jerry Glanville would like to exploit if he can. He's doing so right now.
Split backs on second and five from the 48. They've yet to go to the air. And they still keep it on the ground. And this is Rozier, who takes the ball to the 50-yard line. He is tackled there by Bob Golic, the veteran nose tackle in his ninth year out of Notre Dame.
One thing when you talk to the Cleveland Brown players that they repeatedly talked about was how important it is for us to get off to a good start tonight. Houston has doubts as to whether or not they can beat Cleveland. I talked about them winning seven out of the last eight, the Browns. The only one the Oilers won was a replacement game last year during the strike. So most of the members of this Oiler team have never beaten the Cleveland Browns. And conversely, most of the Browns have never even lost to the Oilers. So if you're a Browns fan or player, you don't want Houston to get confidence early.
And Warren Moon, lifetime is 0-7 against Cleveland. And out of the shotgun, they snap it to Highsmith. And on a little razzle-dazzle, the first down at the 41-yard line. So they line up in the gun, but instead of the snap going to Moon, they snap it to Highsmith. He's stopped by Wright. First down, Houston.
Nifty little play. This is Warren Moon over on this side. This is Highsmith on this side. Watch the snap come to Highsmith and how quickly he gets right up into the middle. A nifty little call by Jerry Glanville. The fake by Moon, like he's got the ball, dropping back, and the missed tackle at the line of scrimmage. And it doesn't take Houston long to get right into their game plan, which includes just about everything.
At the Cleveland 42-yard line with Gibbons, number 81, in motion. And again, they keep it on the ground. And this is Rozier taking it to the 40-yard line. So Rozier picks up three. The inside linebacker, number 59, Mike Johnson, makes the tackle. It will be second down and seven. The Oilers, who I mentioned before with that underrated rushing game, and as you can see there, this year, almost half the time or half the yardage they've gained has been on the ground, quite in contrast to the league as a whole.
Yeah, well, they're going to have to throw it seven times in a row just to get down to that rate. They have not thrown a pass yet. 6-0.
Moon on second down, call it eight from the 40-yard line. Pinkett is in the game for the first time behind Moon. He's number 20. And on a short roll, the pass is caught by Givens. On the outside, Givens is out of bounds at about the 34, 2 yards shy of the first down, covered on the play by Mark Harper.
What the Oilers like to do, and they did it successfully against Washington, four wide receivers. And it neutralizes sometimes Frank Minifield and Hanford Dixon. They have to line up man for man, and you get a crossing pattern underneath, and you get the completion.
You notice they didn't spread the field, though, that time, Frank. They put 3-1 side and went to that side. Something to follow is see if they continue that with the four wideouts, flooding the field to one side, and then come back to the one guy on the far side of the field who's going to be locked up on single coverage.
Houston wants to know where Minifield and Dixon are on every occasion.
Third down, 2 from the 34-yard line. And Rozier is stopped at the line of scrimmage. Mike Rozier pushed back by 4 Browns, led by Mike Johnson.
And there is Charles Buchanan, number 72, giving Mike Rozier a little push way after the play. And it's funny because that's the type of play that I think most people attribute to the Houston Oilers. And that is Rozier carrying the football. A good look at him here going off the left side. Well played by the Browns defensively. Mike Johnson right in there stuffing that play. But here's Buchanan with a little shove clearly after the play. I don't think the Browns, after getting it started like that, are going to be able to complain too much if the Oilers pick up the pace.
Now, Tony Zendejas is having a tough season to attempt a 51-yard field goal. Brent Keyes puts it down, and the kick is short, just short. Zendejas, who's been very consistent in his 3 years prior to this one here in Houston, but this year a whole other story. He is now 8-for-18 in field goal attempts, and Cleveland will get the ball when we come back.
Mustang GT, for people who want more out of life than a little peace and quiet. It's a Radio Shack Merry Christmas.
Get super savings this Christmas on Tandy 1000 computer systems. They're IBM PC compatible and include incredibly easy to use Deskmate software and color monitor. The HX is perfect for home and schoolwork. A faster SL is great for more advanced applications. The more powerful TL is ideal for business at home. And some of us even have innovative sound and speech.
Sale price Tandy 1000 computer systems from $7.99 to $13.99, only at Radio Shack.
When we played for Oakland, we did not appreciate losing.
Our motto was, just win, baby.
Yeah, but now we just like to play a quiet game of pool and drink a few cold Miller Lights.
Lights brewed from the ground up, so it tastes great.
Not like some watered-down version of a regular beer.
Your turn, Otis.
Hey, you cheated.
So?
So, nice shot.
When it's Miller Lite, less filling, tastes great.
Car and Driver named Ford Taurus to its list of 10 best cars in the world the year Taurus was introduced. Even more impressive is the fact that Taurus has remained on that list every year since.
So the Cleveland Browns have the football for the first time in the game. And Bernie Kosar, who was hurt opening day, elbow injury, shelled him until 3 weeks ago. He came back against Phoenix, and now the back of 6-3 from the 34-yard line. First and 10 Brown. Ernest Biner in motion, the fake to Mack, and Kosar hits Biner, and Biner with a first down. He's their leading receiver. He's run out of bounds by Lyles. That's the 33rd ball caught by Biner this season. Kevin Mack has been hurt. He missed all of last week's game and was hurt on the first play of the Phoenix game the week prior, but he's back with Biner. Langhorne and Weathers are the wideouts. Newsom is the tight end. Farron Bolden, Rakosi, Fike, and Cody Risen form a very good, very potent Cleveland offensive line, which, however, tonight is minus Larry Williams. He's on the inactive list, hurt. And Bolden takes his spot at right guard. First and 10, Browns from the 50-yard line. Kosar going deep and overshooting Clarence Weathers. Weathers was the featured receiver last week. They are without Webster Slaughter. He broke a forearm, and they hope to get him back if they get to the playoffs. And so they look to Weathers and Langhorne these days.
Al and Dan, as we watch Bernie Kosar go way up on top, we can recall what he said to us last night. He just wanted to make sure they are going to know that arm is perfectly all right. He threw that about 55 yards in the air.
Childress recovered three fumbles last week. Smith and Fuller. And the linebackers, they don't really stand out, but relatively consistent. Lyles, Grimsley, Smith, and Meads. And then the secondary, Brown and Allen at the corners, Bostic and Donaldson. And Donaldson's having a great year at free safety. Second and 10 from the 50-yard line. Kevin Mack, who missed all of last week's game, none the worse for wear, and a flag goes down back up at the 45 as Mack is finally tackled at the 36 by Houston, Grimsley and Brown.
Houston was across the line of scrimmage at the snap of the football. Question now is whether the Browns threw them off, and we're going to have a holding call, looks like, against Cleveland.
That flag coming in there very late, and the Browns are already backing up.
Schottenheimer dismayed by the call, and we'll get it in a moment from Tom Dooley, who is the referee.
I think we're going to have a couple calls here. I mean, Houston was offsides, and it drew the flag from the far side.
Holding,
of the
field. 81 offense. Offsides, 91 defense. The penalty's offset, second down.
Well, a major and a minor,
mm-hmm.
Offsetting.
Right.
And a break, though, for Houston, in as much as Mack had picked up about 14 yards.
Yeah, because then it was a free play all the way for the Browns anyway, with the Oilers committing the offsides right off the bat. So clearly a break for the Oilers to bring that back and start over.
Second and 10 from the 50-yard line, 9 minutes and 19 seconds left in the first quarter at the Astrodome. The winner will be a game behind Cincinnati in the Central. The loser, 2 games behind the Bengals with 6 to go. Second and 10. And the Oilers jump off again. This time it's number 96, Sean Jones, the former Raider, the pass rush specialist. Off too early.
This is Sean Jones right here. Watch him come over and hit Ricky Bolden right on the back. Ricky Bolden in there at left guard, and Jones, no one on the Browns moved. You see Ozzie Newsome at the bottom give a little flinch, but that's after Jones is across.
Number 96 defense.
And a little bit of that, I would have to think, is playing the Browns on Monday Night Football early in the game, and these guys haven't really worked out all that pregame tension yet, and it's not uncommon to see some offsides early in a big game like this.
Houston, as we mentioned earlier, leading the league in penalties and yards penalized. They are on a pace that would set a record, an NFL record, in each category.
And Jerry Glanville might be the only coach in the league that really wouldn't disturb all that much, as long as they continue to win.
Clock to 9:19.
You touched on something earlier, Dan, about the Cleveland Browns would like to take something out of these Oilers early if they can, get the crowd out of it. Crowd, thus far, nothing really to get wild about with the Oilers. But the Oilers, remember, a year ago, they were also 6-3 when the Browns came in here, and they just demolished them 40-7. And it's a team that I agree. I think they show on the surface a lot of confidence, and you really wonder if it's under there. The Browns, having beaten them 7 out of 8, and the only loss they've had is that strike game.
Second and 5, and this is Kevin Mack, and he gets wrapped up after a gain of a yard and a half by Ray Childress, really coming into his own, a number one draft pick in 1985 out of Texas A&M, last week tying an NFL record, recovering 3 opponents' fumbles and having his best season.
Childress is a guy that came to Houston with so many expectations of greatness. Not only was he their number one choice, but he was the 3rd player taken in the entire draft, and an excellent look at how a defensive end should work his way down the line of scrimmage, keeping his shoulders parallel to that line, and then when that running back cuts back, you're in position to make the play, and that's exactly what Childress did.
The acquisition of Sean Jones on the other side has also helped Childress a great deal on the left side. You just cannot be concerned with Childress alone anymore.
Third and a short five from the 45-yard line. Out of the shotgun, he hits Langhorne, and a first down at the 30-yard line. And that's something that Kozar has gone back to. They used the shotgun with disastrous results, briefly in 85, not at all in 86 and 87. And since he's come back from the injury, he has the option of lining up in the gun.
On the opposite side of the field, Reggie Langhorne had a great day a week ago, and also Clarence Weathers. They missed Webster Slaughter a great deal, but that time Langhorne got the single coverage, made the most of it, and Kozar hit him right on the break.
The reason there was single coverage is because Jeff Donaldson came on the safety blitz right up the middle. He knocked Bernie about 3 yards back, but Bernie stayed right in there, knowing he had the single coverage, and makes the pass.
Good read by both receiver and quarterback.
First and 10, Browns at the 29-yard line. Kevin Mack chugs through the middle for three to the 26. It'll be second down and seven with 7.5 minutes to play in a scoreless first quarter. The Browns, a couple of years ago, 1985 to be precise, both Biner and Mack gained 1,000 yards apiece, but this year they've spread it around. Of course, Mack has been hurt, but Manoa and Mack coming in with 351 yards and Biner at 303.
But if you'll notice, between the three of them, they're over 1,000 yards.
Second down and seven from the 26. And it's Mack again. Stopped at the 25-yard line after a gain of one. It'll set up a third and six. Doug Smith, the nose tackle, number 99, in on the initial contact.
Houston changing their defensive alignment. Key play for the Browns. Last week, the Houston Oilers literally overwhelmed the Washington Redskins on passing situations. They live by that. They live very dangerously, and Bernie Kozar knows he has to be very patient with it. He knows he's going to get the rush. Sometimes he's going to have to throw it away, but he's also going to get the kind of coverage you get with a blitzing defense, and that's man-on-man. If you're patient, sooner or later, you're going to get a man wide open.
Kozar comes up in the shotgun, third and six at the Houston 25-yard line. Bernie is flushed out by Childress, then throws complete, but only to the 21-yard line, caught there by Reggie Langhorne, short of the first down. And that will bring in Barr to attempt a field goal. Bostic and Lyles converging on the tackle.
I think in a nutshell, we just saw what the Oilers would like to do to the Browns on a passing situation. Number one, make Bernie Kozar move. He is not John Elway when he's on the move. If you make Bernie Kozar leave the pocket, it has moved to your advantage defensively. And that time they knew the distance. They gave him the short route underneath. Go ahead, let him make the pass. Let him make the reception. But it's not enough yardage for a first down.
And then, as you notice, they did it with a three-man rush, giving them good double coverage. Kozar had no place to put it.
40-yard attempt for Barr. Runniger puts it down, and Barr, who is 18 of 21 this year, is now 19 of 22. So his spectacular season continues. Cleveland draws first blood. 5:18 to go first quarter. 3-0 Browns.
KTRE-TV, Lufkin, Nacogdoches.
Americans have made Tough Ford the best-selling big pickup for the past 12 years.
$300 cash bonus on manual transmission F-Series pickups during Ford Truck Month.
You know, it was great growing up on our ranch in Oklahoma. And now when I walk into a New York City restaurant and order up a little bitty Kansas City strip, makes me feel right at home.
Oh, I've got a taste for some real food. It was an awful sound.
The most awful sound.
Amen.
It was a hissing.
It was a buzz. Awful.
You cannot describe it with the human mouth.
Say no more.
If your long distance sounds bad, call and hear why 9 out of 10 business people prefer the sound of U.S. Sprint.
The Houston Oilers, charter members of the American Football League in 1960, and they were quarterbacked in their formative years by George Blanda, number 16, who threw an AFL record 36 touchdown passes in 1961. And back in Houston, no, it's not Cleveland, but there's some Browns fans are here. No doubt their tickets are in section K9.
Oh, the kennel in the end zone.
The dog pound. It's not the kennel, it's the dog pound. They'd rather sit in the end zone.
No designer dogs here.
K9. Oh.
Cheap seats. Barr kicks off, fielded by Harris at the 6-yard line. And Leonard Harris comes back out, and a flag is down, 2 in fact, as he returns it to the 14-yard line, and he's tackled by Stephen Braggs. And we can tell you that tomorrow, from the ABC News Election Command Center, Peter Jennings and David Brinkley will lead the best political team in the business. Get out and vote, and then watch it count with ABC News beginning at 7 p.m. Eastern Time tomorrow, live.
What's the old saying? If you don't vote, you can't complain. Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow's the day, and it's obviously a big day as well in this city. The focal point tomorrow for the Bush campaign as they get set up at the convention center here in Houston.
Yes, of course, Bush's legal resident.
Mm-hmm.
He'll be in town. Everyone's fired up.
And the Oilers gave up 10 yards. They were penalized on that kick return as they set up shop now way back.
At the 9-yard line, first and 10. Warren Moon with Highsmith and Rozier behind him. Begin the drive on the ground, and this is Highsmith, who had a big night against Washington last Sunday, using him more and more in his second year out of Miami, where as he was beginning his, or actually he was a freshman, and I believe Bernie Kosar was still there, wrapping up his aborted career of sorts at Miami. Bernie came out early, not only a great student, but opted to become available in the supplemental draft, and that's how Cleveland wound up with him.
You know, Highsmith gave notice he was going to turn into quite a pro while he was at Miami. He had 92 receptions there. Actually went to Miami as a defensive end and a linebacker. Big, strong, and we know he can run with it.
Second and 7 from the 12. Moon on a straight drop, steps up, throws, and it's caught by Givens. He takes it to the 20-yard line. He's wrapped up by Matthews, and he has a first down. Ernest Givens in his third season out of Louisville, and for the most part tonight, he'll be matched up against another man who went to Louisville in Minifield, but not on this particular play.
This time it's Clay Matthews dropping back in the zone, and that's an excellent job that time of Warren Moon reading the zone. And also of Ernest Givens realizing that soft cushion is underneath, not being greedy, not going for 15 when only 8 or 9 would suffice. He went just far enough to pick up the Oiler first down.
4 wide receivers in again for Houston, this time spreading the defense.
Moon, 2 for his first 2. And now he's 3 for 3. Givens slips a tackle, picks up a first down, and a lot more as Givens takes it out to the 43-yard line. Finally, Eddie Johnson catches up to make the play.
Mark Harper missed that tackle. Good move by Givens.
Yeah, you wouldn't expect a guy who's only 5'9 and 172 pounds to be that kind of an open field runner, but that's the kind of performance Ernest Givens turns in here. Harper just puts the head down and you assume closes the eyes or whatever, and look at Ernest Givens. Breaks a couple tackles with speed, and I like a wide receiver. Even though he's not a big guy, he doesn't duck out of bounds. Comes back into the field of play and takes on a couple of defenders.
At the 42, first and 10, Oilers. Moon throwing it out of bounds, intended for Drew Hill, and the pressure was put on Moon that time. As he releases early with 2:36 to go in the quarter, Bob Golic chasing him down with a big grin.
He may have had the funniest line about his move from linebacker to nose tackle years ago, talking about his personal de-evolution in the game of football, going from a rather glamorous position like linebacker down to maybe the most unglamorous position on the field, nose tackle. Smart cookie, Bob Golic from Notre Dame.
Was he the one that had the line when President Reagan came to visit the Browns this week? And he threw a pass, President Reagan threw a pass and completed. He said, the first Browns quarterback this year to throw a pass without getting hurt.
And it's true.
Free spirit, Bob Golic.
Second and 10 from the 42-yard line. Moon throwing low and incomplete. He tried to hit Willie Drury. And low's not a bad spot normally with Drury, who's 5 feet seven, but that one was too low.
How about Jekyll and Hyde here, the Houston Oilers, in their first and their second drives of this ballgame? First drive of the ballgame, they open up with six consecutive runs. Now this time they get the ball deep in their own territory, and rather being conservative, it's almost exclusively throwing the football.
You had a quick look at the brain trust. Jerry Glanville, of course, he says, I call all the plays.
Yeah.
The ones that work. And that's June Jones with the headset right to Glanville's left, former quarterback of Portland State and Atlanta Falcons. He basically is the offensive coordinator.
He calls all the plays that don't work.
Third down and 10. Oilers from the 42. Moon has the pass tipped incomplete. It was tipped by Dave Grayson, the linebacker. Fourth down and the first punt of the game coming up.
I think Glanville's got the right idea. He's going to do it his way because he just looks at the history. This franchise has been around since 1960. They've had 13 head coaches. And he came 3 years ago, and that's averaged a little under 2 years a coach. You may as well do it your way because you don't stick around very long here.
Rookie punter Greg Montgomery to boot it away. They picked him in the third round out of Michigan State. And the ice cube, Gerald McNeil, who went over the 1,000-yard mark, lifetime and punt return yardage last week, to put his name into the Browns record book. Short line drive kick that bounces. McNeil at the 20, flips the tackle there, and brings it back out to the 30-yard line. Run out by John Grimsley. 2:15 remaining first quarter. Cleveland has the ball and a 3-0 lead in Houston.
I'm the big daddy of the greatest bar game of all time, Fuseball. And us Fuseballers drink Miller Lite. Miller Lite's a less filling beer. It's brewed from the ground up. It's not a watered-down version of regular beer. And Fuseball is a great game. Because when a guy loses, everyone knows he loses.
When it's Miller Lite, less filling, tastes great.
I think we have a loser. Hey, barehanded!
Delta Airlines flight attendant Irene Lockwoody loves to fly.
Are you still here?
My son was supposed to meet me.
Well, I'll wait with you.
That kid is always late.
What she loves most are the people she meets.
He must have gotten caught in the rain.
He was even born late.
Irene is what Delta's all about.
Irene?
Yes?
Are you married?
Yep. Two kids.
Late again, Joey.
We love to fly and it shows.
We knew this day would come. You're grown up now and off on your own. It's a relief to know you're not going off by yourself. We found you the perfect escort, a Ford Escort, with performance we can trust and quality we can believe in. Oh, we checked out the imports, but hey, they're not Ford.
Daddy, my Escort's perfect.
Now get a $400 cash bonus on Ford Escort.
The most monumental achievement in motion picture history. Herman Wilkes, War and Remembrance, starting Sunday.
Eugene Seal, and if you're not an everyday player, the way you make your living is by covering punts and kickoffs. This is Eugene right here at the left guard position. Watch him take off and cover a punt. He's going to be held at the line of scrimmage by Clifford Charlton, the linebacker. 5'10", 240 pounds.
Boom.
You don't get them every time.
Yeah, but he got Shepard last week of Washington.
Wow.
Big, big play. This is Kevin Mack starting this drive with about a 7-yard pickup out to the 37. Seals a backup linebacker, and you can do it at 5'9". Just ask Sam Mills of the New Orleans Saints.
Greg Glanville believes in the special teams. He was probably most noted for his special teamwork going back to when he came into this league with Detroit in 74. Had some extraordinary special teams there. He did it at Atlanta, again up at Buffalo before he came down here in 84 as a defensive coordinator.
Well,
he loves special teams.
And you think Glanville would like short guys like Seal. You know, Jerry's not exactly 6'6 either.
Well, he's got those boots on that boots him up there pretty good.
Second and three from the 37-yard line. Off the fake. Gozar, and it's knocked down by Allen, who had Weathers wrapped up at midfield. And the pressure that time put on by Doug Smith, the nose tackle coming in through the middle.
Good coverage by Allen. These cornerbacks, Brown and Allen. Brown on the other side, and let's take a look at it again against Clarence Weathers. Good read, and he watches Weathers, looks into the eyes, and sees the ball on his way and puts the hand in there. Good coverage. Bernie had to let go of it. He was under pressure.
The play-action fake at the line of scrimmage, and the Oilers penetrated. In fact, Bernie got knocked down again. He's been put on the ground virtually every time he's gone back to throw the ball. Third, a long three from just outside the 36-yard line. Browns ahead 3-0. Kozar from the shotgun. Inside handoff, and a fumble. But Herman Fontenot is able to grab it before it hits the ground. He juggled the handoff, and it's sealed in to make the tackle.
Eugene Seal got in on the nickel situation, and boy, did he read this thing.
Lines up at the linebacker position. He's going to come into your picture from the right. There he is getting in there. Cody Risen, the tackle, not able to come down and keep him out of there. And after all that time recovering a punt, it must feel good to get in there on a regular play. Max Runniger, a wobbly kick, fielded on the run by Kenny Johnson, and he brings it back to the 49-yard line, and that gets the crowd stirred up.
And the
players and the Browns as well.
And the players, as a little bit of the in-your-face that we expected tonight starts to materialize over in front of the Houston bench.
That's the kind of move that will fire up a team. A dangerous move by Kenny Johnson. A good move, and he gives the Oilers excellent field position.
From the halls of Montezuma to the shores of Tripoli, we fight our country's battles in the air, on land and sea. On November 10th, the United States Marine Corps celebrates the birth date of its proud and distinguished history. History that will be remembered for that elite corps of men who made it, the Marines. We're looking for a few good men.
When it comes to doing business in faraway lands, you gotta know your way through the jungle. You gotta earn your stripes. You gotta bridge the distance. You can't afford to bungle. You gotta snatch victory from the jaws of defeat. Now is no time to beat around the bush. You gotta help your customers get through customs. They don't want you sitting on your tush. This reminder from Federal Express that it's not just a package, it's your business.
Have you ever wondered what a baggage handler might take on vacation? What everyone should take. Samsonite's glutton for punishment. Get Samsonite's glutton for punishment, because no one knows what goes on behind closed doors.
It's a shootout between two of the NFL's top guns. Jim Kelly and the front-running Buffalo Bills take on Dan Marino and the Dolphins next week on Monday Night Football.
We talk about the Oilers and their aggressiveness. Watch Kenny Johnson here as he goes down, number 56, going to go right over the top. That's Toby Kasten. Watch him sail over the top and hit Eddie Johnson. Domingo Bryant, one of his teammates, in there as well. And that's what started that altercation, and that's where the Oilers like to play football, right on the edge. You can't call that a late hit. Can't call it an early hit, but it's not a penalty situation.
You had it right on the edge.
Right on the edge is where they live.
Final minute of the first quarter, and Houston from the 49-yard line, and the pass is off the fingertips of Rozier. They don't throw to Rozier that much. Rozier, coming into tonight's game, had caught a total of 5 balls in Houston's first 9 games.
Yeah, but the way that he was covered by the Browns, I'd go back to him. You never did see a Cleveland Brown defender come into the picture. Mike Rozier didn't have anyone within 10 yards of him.
Browns, of course, read those numbers also, and they look at the films, and they know that Rozier is not a prime target, not even considered in most of the pass patterns of the Houston Oilers.
Moon started by completing his first 3. However, he has misfired on his last 4. He's now 3 out of 7, and that's Pinkett in the game, and they split him wide to the right. 3 wide receivers in this set. 2nd and 10. Givens in the slot, Hill to the near side. Highsmith stays in to block, and the pass over the middle, and the catch is made by Hill, who's upended by Felix Wright, and Hill pays the price after getting a first down at the 27-yard line.
You have to hope he is all right. Just the mere fact that he went up to get it and held on to it, incredible concentration, because he knew he was going to get that shot from Wright.
And that's where Warren Moon is going all the way. Drew Hill is coming in from the left side. He slanted from his outside position. Felix Wright coming over from the inside, his safety position. And every wide receiver in the game at some point or another ends up in the air in that totally helpless position. Give Drew Hill all the compliments in the world for maintaining his concentration on the ball, holding on to it even after landing on the ground.
We're looking at it in slow motion. That's how it appears to the receiver. When he goes up for that football, it's like slow motion. And he's calculating the moment the ball is going to impact with the hands and the moment that that defender is going to impact on the body.
If you are a free safety like Felix Wright, you get those kind of shots a lot where the guy coming across the middle is exposed. And here's some good news, Drew Hill on his feet. And as we saw him land, Frank, the best part of the whole thing was that he landed more on his shoulder and not on his head.
Very athletic move, as a matter of fact, and to control the ball also.
And he's coming off as good a game as he's had in his career. Last week, 9 catches, 3 touchdowns, 1,000 yards in 85 and 86, and close to 1,000 last year. And
big smile,
it appears
like
he'll be back in a couple of plays.
And one of the few guys on the field that's been in a Super Bowl.
He might have a visit with Warren Moon, say, hey pal, just don't look at me quite so quickly next time. Moon followed him all the way, and that was like calling Felix Wright to the point of attack.
So the clock starts again. As the Oilers have it at the 27-yard line, and this will be the final play of the period. It's a toss to Rozier, and he takes it to the 20-yard line. It'll be 2nd down and 3 at the 20-yard line when the second quarter begins. Alonzo Highsmith paved the way for Rozier's run with a nice block. 3-0 Cleveland after the first quarter. Back in Houston after this message and a word from your local station.
I'm known for my gentle and charming disposition. So when Ernie here ran out of Miller Lite, I didn't get mad. Nah. We calmly discussed the situation. I told Ernie I drink light because it's brewed from the ground up, so it tastes great. Not like some watered-down version of a regular beer. We reached an understanding, and he quickly rectified the situation. Mom always said I had a way with people.
When it's Miller Lite, less filling, tastes great.
When it comes to making a serious decision, my brother Tom is a lot smarter than he appears to be. Like most thinking Americans, Tom is looking for a contemporary, innovative leader, a leader with quality he can believe in, a leader he can trust.
Yeah.
Now, he has looked at a lot of television, listened to claims from all sides,
yes.
And after careful consideration, Tom has made the smart choice, and that choice is Magnavox. The sign.
Magnavox, smart choice, very smart.
KTRE-TV, the East Texas station.
Angelina Chevrolet Cadillac.
Angelina Chevrolet Cadillac in Lufkin has a good selection of 89 Chevy trucks now. Trucks for heavy-duty jobs and trucks for just the fun of it. When you think trucks, think Angelina Chevrolet Cadillac, home of Mr. Goodrich. No one knows your GM car or truck better. No one.
We want to be your dealer. Angelina Chevrolet Cadillac.
Brought to you by Buick and your Buick dealer. The great American road belongs to Buick.
The Astrodome in Houston, under construction. They're adding 10 to 12,000 seats prior to the beginning of next football season and hope to have several of them in by the time baseball season begins here in April. Second down and three from the 20-yard line as the second quarter gets underway, and a first down as Highsmith takes it to the 15-yard line. So Houston on the move with Cleveland ahead, 3-0.
I think one of the reasons, Al and Frank, that Houston's doing a little better offensively this drive is look how much better they're mixing it up. Remember, drive number one is almost exclusively on the ground. Drive number two is almost exclusively in the air. And this, by far and away, their best mix of both the run and the pass. Either Rozier out of the eye, Drew Hill over the middle, that time for a first down. A good overall offensive scheme this time by Houston.
On this drive, two runs and two passes. This one started at their own 49-yard line, first and 10 at the 16. Rozier inside the 10-yard line. Loose football, but the play was dead. The play was over. No fumble.
I think the fans are just starting to figure that out.
No fumble, Houston ball at the 9.
Okay, we talked about the complete football player earlier that Alonzo Highsmith has rapidly turned into. He made a vicious block ahead of Rozier and enabled Rozier to get inside the 10-yard line.
Highsmith, the best blocker on the Houston Oilers team out of the backfield. And you're right, he just put a devastating block on Eddie Johnson, it was, the inside linebacker.
He just rolled Johnson up. About as good a block as you're going to see by a setback.
Schottenheimer looking on. Hopeful his defensive unit can stiffen, and they've been tough throughout the season. Second down and three from the 9-yard line with Gibbons in motion. Rozier to the left side, cuts it back inside for a first down to the 4. Good movement by a guy who would be, in a way, the quintessential slasher-type runner, Mike Rozier.
We talked about it earlier, the Cleveland defense, a lot of celebrity thus far in this year, but mostly against the pass. Where they have been weak, it's been against the run, and this is what Gary Glanville, the Houston Oilers, wanted to do on offense, and they've been able to do it. They came into tonight 20th in the league against the run, first against the pass, but Houston's moved on the ground and well.
Houston at the 4, early second quarter. Cleveland leading 3-0. Rozier. Whoa. Stopped at the 1. Mike Johnson created that somersault.
Another athletic move by Rozier. We saw it a moment ago by Drew Hill. This time, upended completely, and you can lose that ball so easily when you get into that position, trying to come down, trying to make a good move. There's the hit. Up goes Rozier. Totally 360s it and holds on to the football.
I think Rozier really times his leap well. That leap is going to carry him into the end zone, given his momentum. But give Brian Washington credit. He got into Rozier's legs, turned him upside down enough that he lands short of the goal line. Without Washington, that's a Houston touchdown.
Second and goal from the 1. Highsmith. Touchdown.
That time, Rozier with a great block in front of Highsmith. Wow, they really complement each other well. Highsmith a moment ago with a great block, Rozier. This time Rozier with a key block.
That block is going to be on Brian Washington. Here's Washington. Watch him with the quick force upfield, and you're going to see the block by Rozier out in front of Alonzo Highsmith. Look at Mike Rozier get into the legs of Washington, put him onto the ground, and that allows Highsmith to just high-step it into the end zone. And Frank, you're right. They complement each other well.
Munchik, the Pro Bowl guard, number 63, also with a big block. Tony Zendejas for the point after. Marker down. Kick was good. And we'll see about the penalty.
Alonzo Highsmith deserved the right to carry that in. He'd had two devastating blocks in a row for Mike Rozier, and that time they had a trade.
Both players on the defense. Point is good. Put Lyles on the kickoff.
Well, the Browns, believing that a dozen is the way to block a kick, get caught. Another look at Alonzo Highsmith, and his one-yard run gives Houston the lead.
IBM presents You Make the Call. A Warren Moon pass is intercepted by Clay Matthews of the Browns, who is hit and fumbles the ball forward, where it is last touched by an Oiler before it goes out of bounds. Now you make the call. Whose ball is it and where?
Hello? Need a shipping date? Yeah. Oh, hold on a second. Hello? You want research? Yo, price change?
The IBM Personal System 2.
Research here. All trends are up.
Runs today's most popular business program.
Shipping. Be out in 10 days.
With superior graphics and speed.
The price on that...
The price is $89.99.
No wonder it's today's fastest selling computer. The Personal System 2 family, part of the bigger picture from IBM.
What call did you make? No matter who touched it last, a fumble forward out of bounds belongs to the team last in possession at the spot of the fumble.
The new Buick Riviera. It's a classic all over again.
The road has been waiting, you're anticipating the spirit you felt way back when.
Riviera is back, a classic again.
It's a legend once more, what the road's waiting for.
Riviera, a classic returns.
Oh, the great American road belongs to Buick.
Cleveland was the host city for the first ever Monday Night Football game. September 21st, 1970, Browns led the Jets by 7 at the half. The second half kickoff return 94 yards for a touchdown by Homer Jones as the Browns beat the Jets 31-21. Al Michaels with Frank Gifford and Dan Dierdorf at the Astrodome in Houston against Cincinnati on top in the AFC Central. A mark of 8-2. The winner of this game would be in second place with a mark of 7-3. Loser drops to third at 6-4. So the way things are shaping up, this is the toughest of the divisions right now. And if the season were to stop after the game tonight, both these teams would still go to the playoffs as the wild cards from the AFC.
So it's far from a hopeless situation for the loser of this game.
Zendejas kicks off. This is Herman Fontenot, who had a big run back last week against Cincinnati, and this time he is stuffed at the 15-yard line. Walter Johnson in on the tackle. Let's go back to the touchdown by Highsmith.
Yeah, Frank mentioned the block by Mike Munchak. This is him, the left guard. Watch the job he does on Eddie Johnson as Johnson pulls. Munchak pulls out. Take a look at this block. Munchak clears the garbage inside, gets into Eddie Johnson's feet, and puts him down on the ground and effectively makes Mike Johnson, the other linebacker, run around behind him. So between Rozier's block at the point of attack and then Munchak coming around, no Brown had a shot that time at Alonzo Highsmith.
Highsmith scoring his first touchdown of the season. The football is at the 14-yard line as Cleveland begins this drive. And Kevin Mack goes nowhere. Fumbles the ball, and Cleveland has it. It's Bernie Kosar falling on it at the 7-yard line after Mack's fourth fumble of the season.
And it has been a while since a ball took that good of a roll for the Cleveland Browns. The only guy in a position to recover that fumble is Bernie Kosar, and it just dribbles right towards him. Kevin Mack, the only thing you can fault him for is trying to make something happen. Reverses his field, a clear fumble, and look at that ball after Ray Childress hits it with his right hand, roll right to Bernie Kosar.
Well, second down and 18 now from the 7.
It's a great down. Second long yardage for Houston to just turn it loose. They love to come on second and long, as most teams love to do.
They keep Mack in the block, and Posar finds the tight end. That's Ozzie Newsome to the 15-yard line, and Ozzie Newsome has now caught a pass in 137 consecutive games, the second longest streak in history. The longest, of course, belongs to Steve Largent, who added one more yesterday and now has caught passes in 162 straight.
And that streak of Ozzie's almost came to an end last week in their game against Cincinnati. I think there was only like 3 minutes left in the ball game when Bernie gets him the football for only a 5-yard gain. And I asked Bernie about that, and he said, "You better believe I knew Ozzie didn't have a catch." Mm-hmm. He likes to keep track of every one of his receivers and backs and how many receptions they have.
Third and 10 now from the 15, from the shotgun. Bozar stepping up, throwing at the 30-yard line, and it's incomplete. Bounced into the hands of Langhorne.
And for the first time tonight, you sense this crowd is beginning to smell a little blood. They're on their feet, they're cheering the defensive unit. It's been a very quiet, almost subdued crowd compared to the one we watched a week ago on last Sunday night against the Redskins.
And you know, Langhorne was really open on that play. Reggie had settled in to a nice hole in the Oiler defense, but again, they forced Kozar out of the pocket. He's not as effective.
Max Runniger to kick. It's a short line drive kick, but takes a good bounce for him. Fielded by Johnson, and he has no blocking. And Kenny Johnson is stopped at the 42-yard line.
What a play Johnson made, however. That ball could have gone all the way to the 20-yard line. He took the risk. He went up, batted it into the air, and was able to save it from going perhaps to the 20-yard line.
Introducing an automobile that will change the way you think about two-seaters. Riata by Buick, the premium American two-seater you can be comfortable with. Riata offers a high level of luxury, sophisticated conveniences, and a remarkable amount of room at a most attractive price. If your aim in life has always been high, drive the premium American two-seater. Riata by Buick. Go ahead. You deserve it.
Before your tires show uneven wear, have your alignment checked. Or you could be shortening tire life and taking risks. At Midas, trained professionals with the latest technology align your car right.
Hey, nobody beats Midas. Nobody.
We're looking for a few good men with a medal to be Marines.
Jerry Glanville, who took this team to the playoffs last year. You'll recall they beat Seattle in overtime and then were demolished by Denver. And the most controversial play in postseason last year was that stagger lead disaster.
Here, that illustrates what I had been talking about earlier about the first drive predominantly rushing the ball, second was passing the ball, and a little better mixture there in the end, and that was offset a little bit down by the goal line when they rushed the ball almost exclusively in the goal line situation.
So now they begin from the 42-yard line. No stagger lead in the playbook tonight as Rozier takes it out to the 47. And just to follow up, you'll recall last year when that game started in Denver, Houston was pinned deep after the opening kickoff, tried that swing pass out into the flat, fumble, Denver recovered, went in for the touchdown. And for all practical intents and purposes, that game was over.
And it really upset a lot of the Houston people, some of the players included, coaches as well, because they thought that physically they were in a position to really carry it to Denver. And as Denver has since shown on a couple of occasions, sometimes it's tough for them to stand up to a real physical running attack. Certainly Washington exploited it in the Super Bowl, and yet Houston in that situation resorted to finesse.
Second and five from the 47-yard line. Rozier again swings to the outside, and Washington comes up to make the tackle. It's very close to a first down as he crosses midfield, takes the ball to the Browns 48 with 8:35 to play in the first half.
Obvious change up on the part of Warren Moon. It gets the place from the sidelines, but he's allowed a lot of liberty in changing it. That time he did change it. You saw the adjustment of the back. He read a Browns defense in which he could take it through the left side, and again, very effective. But Dan and Al, you both know when you can run the football as readily as Houston is running it tonight, that means something else. You can also come with play action pass. And I'm sure we're going to see that develop because they've been able to run just at will thus far.
There's Hairston limping off. Big Daddy in his 14th year with them. A first down after the measurement. So Hairston comes out at right end. Longtime Eagle who came over to the Browns 4 years ago and has helped to solidify the defense.
I can think back to those Eagle days where Carl Hairston is playing the one defensive end, Claude Humphrey is playing the other defensive end, and really Carl Hairston grew weary of Philadelphia going through Dick Vermeil's training camp. He said, I don't want to work that hard. I don't think he's doing any better than Houston.
Sims takes his spot at right end as Rozier takes the toss, picks up four. He moves to the 44-yard line, second down and six. The Trojans of Southern California take on Arizona State, and that's prior to their confrontations with UCLA and Notre Dame. And you'll see USC and Rodney Peete Saturday, those of you in the Midwest, Michigan State against Indiana, at 3:30 Eastern time.
Your alma mater, Al, has never been very cordial to my alma mater.
And we don't plan to be either on Saturday.
I just want you two to know that I'm willing to serve as mediator in whatever dispute or contest or you know what I mean. I don't want to...
We've been reading your mail about Michigan, man.
Right.
No, they're not there yet.
I'm saying if you two would like to wager on this game, I'd be more than willing to hold the proceeds.
Second and six from the 44-yard line as Moon throws complete, and that's the first catch for Leonard Harris, who would be in effect their number five wide receiver. Harris makes the catch at the 42-yard line. It'll be third down and four. And then you saw the graphic illustrating next Monday's game. The team with the best record in the NFL right now, 9-1, the Buffalo Bills, coming off their win over Seattle yesterday, 13-3, against the Miami Dolphins, a critical game for Miami.
And clearly two of the most exciting quarterbacks in the game in Dan Marino and Jim Kelly. But Buffalo, what a story these guys are, huh?
Next week.
Some kind of defense.
Bennett to Seattle yesterday in Seattle.
Conlon, a lot of dynamic people.
Third and four from the 42-yard line. And this is Alan Pinkett. And Pinkett is close to a first down. He gets bumped down at the 38-yard line by Hanford Dixon.
Pinkett is the man they like to bring in the middle of the second quarter after a team has been hammered a little bit by the big guys, Rozier and Highsmith. They like to bring Pinkett in because of the quick moves, and you saw it right there. He's having a great year. Over 320 yards rushing. He's had eight touchdowns.
And he's averaging 4.1 a carry. He picks up four here, but he's short of the first down. Fourth and inches.
A good look at what's happening up front. That's Sam Clancy, number 91, just being ridden out of the play by Jay Pennison, the center. And this is a huge Oiler offensive line. Every guy on there over 280, most over 290, some over 300.
Meanwhile, on fourth and inches, the Oilers come up to attempt to go for it, and Cleveland takes a timeout. Cleveland taking a timeout. And whether the Oilers were going to run the play or not, we don't know. Sometimes you just line up. You hope to draw the defense offside. But Cleveland didn't like their alignment, and the Browns take a timeout.
How will you live in the next century? Suddenly, life will be more comfortable, smoother, and quicker. Introducing the new 1989 Buick Century, with premium features you expect from the best-selling Buick on the American road. All at a price that will let you enter the next century very comfortably.
The Great American Road belongs. of Buick.
In the next 4 years, somebody is going to have to continue the arms limitation talks with Gorbachev. Somebody is going to have to find out is for real. Somebody is going to have to deal with him and look him in the eye and not blink. This is no time for uncertainty. No time to train somebody in how to meet with the Russians. This is the time for strength and experience. This is the time for somebody who is ready on day one to be a great president.
Some people see shaving as something you do for 3 minutes a day. At Braun, we see it as something you do for a lifetime. And we think you should make the best of it. The Braun Shaver, with its three shaving positions. Designed for those who choose to make a virtue out of necessity. Braun, the world's number one selling foil shaver.
The number two team in the nation, USC, meets Pac-10 rival Arizona State for a Big Ten matchup as Michigan State tackles Indiana Saturday. College football.
Here's a good look at Frank Minifield, who realizes the Cleveland Browns aren't in the defense they want to be in. What happened to the Browns? We're getting ready to play short yardage, obviously in a fourth and short, and Houston came in with a passing formation. Frank Minifield realized the Browns didn't have enough defensive backs to defense the offensive formation.
He should have kept quiet. The Oilers only had 2 seconds on the clock.
And now they're going to go for it on fourth and one, and on a sneak, it's Moon, who gets the inches and about three more yards to the 35-yard line.
Interesting call by Jerry Glanville that time. Look how he spreads the football field. One, two, three, four wide receivers. Opens up the middle and leaves it for Warren Moon to run that quarterback sneak.
And it worked exactly like he wanted it to work. He came in with the passing offense, and the Browns jumped up, took a timeout. He came right back. I'm sure that was the play he had called before.
When you're only going to use 2 feet of the field in width to run that quarterback sneak, why not spread people all over and get those white jerseys from sideline to sideline?
They keep the ball, first and 10 from the 35. Take it. He's taken down by number 59, Mike Johnson, after a pickup of a couple with 4 minutes and 45 seconds to play in a rapidly moving first half. Houston on top, 5-3.
Both teams very conservative. Both teams wanting to run the football, and this game is moving right along because of it.
Yeah, well, we need a quick first half after that first half we had last week in Indianapolis.
That one went into brunch. Yeah. Boy. This game is just about an hour old. 7-3. Oilers on top. 4:20 to play first half. Second down and 8 at the 33. Givens in motion. Moon intended for Givens. Incomplete.
And boy, does Warren get tagged from the backside. I think it's Michael Dean Perry that put the helmet kiss on him.
The Fridge's brother.
Warren never saw this coming. Good look at William Dean Perry at the top of your screen. He's going to get around behind Bruce Davis, and a right-handed quarterback never sees that coming. And actually, Perry took it easy on him. That's a good job of Michael Dean of pulling up.
That's a good job of getting in there. Good athleticism on the part of Michael Dean Perry, who has 4 sacks on the year.
And he'll wind up with a lot more than his brother, who's out for the season with his fractured wrist in Chicago. 3rd and 8 from the 33-yard line. Draw, Rozier, and Cleveland smells it out, and down he goes on a corner blitz.
They
with
saw
Mark
that.
Harper, number 23.
They saw that on an identical situation in the first quarter.
And I think it's Michael Dean Perry again who's the first guy in there. He's getting upfield so quick, getting around Bruce Davis. That play never had a chance to unfold. So Perry, 2 times in a row, effective in Houston's backfield.
And out of any possibility, field goal range, good play.
It means Montgomery comes in to punt with 3.5 minutes to go in the half. McNeil to receive at the 10-yard line. And it will be downed. No, not down. They never had possession of it to the extent
It was inside the five. It is ruled a touchback.
Eric Fairs riding right into the football. He saw it was taking a big Cleveland bounce, but he could not control it either.
Did you see the ice cube that time? Gerald McNeil, the guy back there to field that punt, goes ahead and tackles the cover guy. Here's a good look at it, guys. Thanks for getting us up. Watch McNeil go ahead and horse collar. That's number 28 for the Oilers, Chris Dishman, who's down there trying to down the punt. I think McNeil got away with one right there. He spun him all the way backwards. Of course, the cube's a pretty big guy. Mm-hmm. I can see why he's taking everybody on. 5'7", 147 pounds.
And the Oilers, despite an advantageous initial bounce, were unable to down the ball before it crossed the plane of the goal line, and thus Cleveland has it after the touchback at the 20-yard line. They have two timeouts remaining in the half as Kozar starts by going deep, hits Langhorn, and Langhorn had control of it, so it's a fumble, but Cleveland recovers.
Well, that's twice the ball is rolled right back to the Cleveland Browns. First, it's Kevin Mack that fumbles it. It rolls to Bernie Kozar, and this time Reggie Langhorn puts it on the ground and is able to crawl back on top of it.
Keith Bostic put the hit on Langhorn that jarred the ball loose. And he just split the zone, and sometimes you can get away with this sort of a thing. Warren Moon was talking about it today. Sometimes you can just outrun the zone. That was the situation there. Well-thrown ball by Kozar.
Well, this has been a fortunate second quarter for the Browns in terms of how the ball rolls.
Mm-hmm. 31-yard gain. Ball at the 49 of Houston. Kozar protected well, but nobody's open. It'll be second down and 10. Last week, all of the bounces went to Houston. Washington putting the ball on the ground to the extent the Oilers recovered five fumbles, and they also had an interception en route to their 41-17 victory. But tonight, Cleveland pouncing on both its fumbles to this point.
Kozar looking to the sidelines, getting the play, but a moment ago you saw what we were talking about earlier about the patience of Kozar. He's not had big games against the Houston Oilers. Some of them have been kind of dreadful, made dreadful by the defense the Oilers have put up, but he has won 5-0.
He's 5-0, and Moon is 0-7.
Lots of folks on the line of scrimmage in blue jerseys.
Second and 10. And most of those folks are coming in. And there's a flag down, and Kozar is down.
Well, Johnny Meade's 91, 40. Who makes that tackle, is a guy who was offsides. Meade comes out of his stance and gets across the line of scrimmage, and even though Meade ends up with a sack, I think that's going to get brought back. Unless we saw someone in Cleveland moving.
There's another flag downfield at the 42 of Houston as well.
Meade is going to contest it. Someone on the Browns moved, but I don't think the officials are buying it.
Houston were in the perfect defense. The Browns had four men in this pattern. They were bringing seven along the line of scrimmage, and Meade, lack of discipline.
Offsides, 91 defense, second down.
They would have got to Kozar no matter what. Just a little discipline, and they would have got the sack. Because the Browns had so many men in the pattern, they just couldn't pick up.
A good look at Meade, who's clearly across the line of scrimmage in that neutral zone with his right hand on the ground at the snap of the football.
Second and 5 at the 44. Kevin Mack only picks up one, another flag at the 43.
An early one and then a later one.
And against Houston again, and that takes us to the 2-minute warning. Clock now stopped with 1:58 to play in the half.
Offsides, 91 defense, first down.
Cleveland moving at the 2-minute warning. Houston leading 7-3.
Going for the hat trick.
It's a Radio Shack Merry Christmas.
The Tandy 1000HX computer is a great family gift. It was sale priced at only $4.99.
And with this color monitor, the system was still less than $7.99.
It's IBM PC compatible and comes with easy-to-use desk-made software.
So the kids can do homework, and we can play Christmas music.
And the $200 savings helps me balance our budget.
Save $200 on the Tandy 1000HX. Only $4.99 with software. Complete system less than $7.99. Only at Radio Shack.
Pure. Genuine.
never heat pasteurized. A beer that's made unlike any other. Cold filtered to give you the rich, smooth taste of real draft beer. That's the mark of a great beer. Cold filtered Miller Genuine Draft. It's as real as it gets.
Buffalo Bills are trying to run away with the AFC East, but the Miami Dolphins are out to narrow that lead. Next week on ABC's Monday Night Football.
2 minutes to go in the first half. Houston on top 7-3. And the Browns have the ball first and 10 at the Oiler 39-yard line. Drive that began at the 20-yard line.
In at halftime, we're going to take a look back at when the Oilers were on top. Things were great and rolling here in Houston. The days of Bum Phillips and Earl Campbell. And Lynn Swann went out and found them this past week.
And a visit with a new manager of the Houston Astros. Named today, Art Howe. At the 39-yard line, Bernie Kosar. Sidearms it to Newsom. His second catch of the night. And Newsom stays inbounds and is finally run out by Lyles. After a big game, Ozzie Newsome, who's caught more passes than any tight end in the history of the National Football League. 19-yard game.
And Ozzie Newsome, an 11-year veteran, I think a lot of people, Frank, didn't think he's capable of these kind of moves downfield. Sidestep and a hurdle.
One of the more exciting ones for Ozzie, and who has been just hanging on to that streak in the last few weeks. Kept it alive last week. We were talking about it a moment ago, but that was a great effort by Newsom to get the Browns deep into Oilers territory, certainly well within field goal range.
First and 10 at the 20. They've covered 60 yards on the drive to this point. They send Newsom in motion. And the ball is given to Tim Manoa. Was hit hard, his first carry of the night, and he has been the main man the last couple of weeks with the injury to Kevin Mack. Manoa out of Penn State.
And Johnny Meads may have bent one of those face masks that Jerry Glanville is so proud of his team for bending and breaking. What, I think they've bent or broken 75 face masks so far here this season, and they're shooting for over 100. Now watch Manoa make a cutback to the left, and Meads is going to come from the left side of your picture. Boom, there he is right there. Staggers Manoa and sends him off in another direction.
Second and 9 from the 19-yard line. Kosar finds Biner, and Biner is hit just short of the first down. Third and 1 at the 11-yard line. Clock is still running, 55 seconds to play in the half.
Great presence by Kosar. Knew exactly where he was, so aware, and was right there to stop the clock. It was looking right into the eyes of the official as soon as the play was ended, saving every second he could. And here's what we thought we'd see a lot more of. Two teams really not getting along too well. That is Ernest Biner getting it on there with Johnny Grimsley, the inside linebacker. Biner perhaps a little overmatched there.
Well, you don't get into a fracas this long after the play is over. I mean, that's just not smart football for either club when you look at where they are in scoring territory, and flags are down. And I think the best thing that these teams hope for is offsetting penalties here.
Mm-hmm. All this taking place during a timeout. Cleveland's second. They have one more timeout remaining with 52 seconds to play.
Well, if these aren't offsetting penalties, I'd hate to be the guy on the team who gets penalized and have to walk over and face either Jerry Glanville or Marty Schottenheimer.
Personal foul, unsportsmanlike conduct. Number 49, 44, Cleveland. Number 51, Houston. Penalties offset. Third down.
He said 51, he meant 59, John Grimsley.
Kozar rolling out of the pocket. He knew he was going to get hit. Still kept his eyes right on that 44. Top of your screen, that's Biner. And he took the shot. Down he goes as Robert Lyles really unloaded on him. And then he was right on his feet to quickly call timeout. Very aware young man. Talented, but also aware of everything that's going on. Dan alluded to the fact a moment ago that he keeps track of his receivers and the numbers of catches, how they've been used in the offense. Very impressive.
I doubt it's very impressive to Jerry Glanville.
He's watched it a few times in the last couple of years.
And almost all of them on the losing side of it.
Third down and one at the 11-yard line. And this is Mack. And he has a first down. And there was a very interesting play that happened just before. Broke the huddle. Ricky Bolden went up to tell the official, I am an eligible receiver, as he lined up on the right side, and had he not, they would have been penalized, and he just did get the point across.
And that may be what Glanville is arguing right there, that he didn't signal it in time.
But Bolden ran out of the huddle to let the umpire know, hey, I'm going to be an eligible receiver in this formation.
Meanwhile, remarkably weak against the goal line offense. That's almost incredible, those numbers.
In this situation, they have not stopped anybody this season. Biner in motion. On first and goal, Kozar with the receiver falling down. And Bernie says, where's the flag? As Langhorne hit the AstroTurf with 40 seconds to go.
And I have to admit, I wonder where the flag is too, because Reggie Langhorne, it appears that Langhorne is just tackled in the end zone by Steve Brown. Brown and Langhorne both ended up on the ground in the end zone.
Meanwhile, they work on Kevin Mack on the Browns bench. So Mack has been shaken up. He is out. There is Kevin. Manoa is in, along with Biner. They have Biner in the slot. Second and goal at the six. Biner in motion. Kozar to Manoa. Tackled at the 10. They have one timeout remaining as the clock ticks down under a half minute.
Tough call. One-man screen. Ricky Bolden out in front of that one-man screen. Kozar, he'll look downfield, try to get the pressure, and then he flips it out, gets it to Manoa, and the Oilers read it all the way.
Meanwhile, the clock down to 9 seconds. It's third and goal. They may not leave themselves time for a field goal if they don't get into the end zone. And they won't, and the pass is overthrown, and they didn't use a timeout, and they can't even attempt a field goal here.
And that is unbelievable. The Cleveland Browns lackadaisically went back to attempt to get into their offensive huddle, took all the time in the world setting up offensively, ran a long snap count at the line, and Jerry Glanville is just, I mean, I can't understand what he's so upset about.
He just dodged a three-point bullet. Kozar just, you've got to lay it right on Kozar.
ABC's NFL Monday Night Football, brought to you by Apple Computer, giving you the power to be your best in home, school, and business.
Time in the Astrodome, key game in the AFC Central Division, and Houston is leading the Cleveland Browns 7-3 in the kind of a football game that I think we all expected, a hard-hitting game, and reminiscent, Lynn, of the Oilers in the late 70s and early 80s under Bum Phillips, when they had a football player, a great football player out of the University of Texas named Earl Campbell. I know it's been a very busy week for you running them down.
Yes, it certainly has, and it reminds me of the games I played when everyone's in the stands pumped up. They're all excited because they play tough football here. They call this place the House of Pain now, and the coach, Jerry Glanville's got a sense of humor, leaving tickets for to see stars like Elvis Presley and James Dean. A sense of humor, that is, that's been started here by Bum Phillips and Earl Campbell. When they played here, they always played the tough football. But when they left this game, they went their separate ways, each with their separate goals. But they truly remain inseparable as we take a look at Bum Phillips and Earl Campbell.
Fulfilling a lifetime dream to be a cattle man, O.A. Bum Phillips rides herd on 4,000 leased acres outside of Houston, Texas.
Got about 700 head of mama cows, and they keep you busy. You know, they're like children. They can find something for you to do. 700 of them, believe me, can find something for you to do every day.
Every day. What's your normal routine?
Well, yesterday was a normal day. I got here at 6:30 and got home at 10. It's kind of like coaching. It takes all you ever waking hour, and sometime after dark.
Earl Campbell returned to the University of Texas, where along with an exhausting schedule of appearances, he is a counselor for the Longhorn football team and a recruiter for the school. Education is his focus.
It would be an embarrassment to our university to have an athlete play here 4 years and then don't do everything in our power to try to help that student athlete get an education.
But it was 10 years ago this month on Monday Night Football that Bum and Earl led the Oilers to the national spotlight. It was Love You Blue, and Earl's 38th carry was the exclamation mark.
On second and eight, Campbell just out runs everyone to the right. Look out!
He's gone!
He's gone! All the way! What a show this man has put on tonight!
Earl led the league in rushing, and Bum led his team to the AFC Championship game. They maintained that success for three consecutive years. During those years at Houston, Earl and Bum were also building a friendship, one that would fill a personal void in Earl's life.
I think the one thing out of my whole life that has kind of bugged me for so long is because my father died at such a young age, you know.
I just kind of always felt like I was close to him, like his dad would have been. I mean, I had a kind of relationship with him that maybe not sound right, but it's true. Never have had to talk about it with Earl. I've never had to tell him I liked him, or he's never had to tell me he liked me. I mean, it was just that way. And it's something that both of us recognize and both of us appreciate.
It started being a big joke on the team because a bum son was a defensive line coach. They said, "Hey, Earl, that go your brother." I said, "Wait, that go your brother Earl." You know, I mean, it was a big thing.
Like father and son, friend and friend, they can also laugh at each other.
Bum Phillips and I have a golf tournament, but it's called the Earl Campbell Bum Phillips Close, simply because there's nobody else can play in this golf tournament.
I said, "Look, the only way we're ever going to settle this is we've got to have something, somewhere keeping a record on it, because, you know, after I beat you, well, and you beat me, well, I lie about it or you lie about it."
You have never had fun till you play golf with Bum Phillips, but that man can cheat.
He don't think I can beat him. I'm 65 and he's 35, and he don't think I can still hit the ball further than him. But I can.
Then one day this summer, the laughter stopped, and Earl faced his biggest fear.
To be honest, I was scared I was going to die.
And my first reaction, of course, is scared me. You know, it's kind of like one of your own children. In our house, we've got pictures. I've got 12 grandchildren and 6 children. Well, right in the middle of all my children and grandchildren is Earl's picture, so that gives you an idea how we feel about him.
The pain was found to be stress-related and not as serious. Earl has since slowed his life down and is focused on what's important for him.
I thought I was pretty close to the good Lord. I think I'm even tighter with him now.
Bless his heart. There ain't gonna never be another Earl. Not for me, there won't anyhow.
That relationship is very unique. Consider this. Most head coaches never get close to their players because they may have to cut them, trade them, or ask them to retire. It's usually the assistant coach. And with all the demands on both their times, then and now, they didn't have a lot of it. And they stay so close. As a matter of fact, Frank, 2 weeks doesn't go by without Bum and Earl talking to each other. So it's just two tall Texans leaning on each other's shoulders.
There'll never be another Bum.
Go the second half at the Astrodome in Houston. Oilers lead 7-3. Zendejas to kick off. Fontenot and Young back to receive for Cleveland. A first half that ended bizarrely with the Browns running out of time, costing themselves at least the opportunity to attempt a field goal, and Glanville losing it. Here we go. Zendejas kicks to Fontenot in the corner at the 8-yard line. And he comes back out to the 21-yard line. When we last tuned in, Jerry Glanville was going wild at the end of the first half.
I like the way he goes to this official, gets something short of a satisfactory response, and then goes right here and ends up having to be restrained by his players. And Initially, he thought the Browns had 12 men on the field. I think he's still upset because he thought maybe Ricky Bolden was late in reporting as an eligible receiver. But quite frankly, I think, Al, you're right. I think he had a meltdown. He was so excited that the Browns squandered a scoring opportunity that he flipped.
Absolutely. And he was the beneficiary.
Yeah, yeah. A little too many hormones floating around in there.
I mean,
how about a little adrenaline?
All natural.
All those things, huh?
If anybody deserved to flip it, was Schottenheimer. Here's Ernest Biner starting the third quarter with a 5-yard pickup through the middle of the 26-yard line. Robert Lyles, the outside backer, makes the tackle. And Kevin Mack is on the bench as we begin the second half. He was shaken up late in the first half. Take a look at the numbers now through the first 30 minutes.
And I think the one statistic that jumps out of there, look at the Browns with only 7 yards on the ground compared to Houston that has 79 and has been extremely effective running the football, but Cleveland getting zilch on the ground.
Houston, well-balanced attack. Second down and 6, and this is Manoah. And we figure to see a lot of Manoah. Now, keep in mind, Max missed all of last week's game and almost all of the Phoenix game. He was hurt very early on in the game against the Cardinals. This time, though, it's a calf pull. He's missed 2 games because of neck and shoulder problems, but the word now, a calf pull, will not be back. So it's Manoah and Biner out of the backfield.
And Manoah coming to the sidelines now because the Browns in a 3rd and 5 situation are going to be in a passing set. That means Tim Manoah to the sideline.
And they come up in the shotgun. Call it 3rd and 6 at the 25-yard line. Kozar looks for Brennan, and it's batted away. Batted away by Richard Johnson in on the nickel package, and also Domingo Bryant.
Johnson, a number 1 draft pick a couple of years ago, making a good play, good pressure on Kozar, who I don't know how familiar what he thinks of the shotgun so far. He just started using it since he came back from the injury.
What's interesting there, though, is that Brennan and flags go flying all over the field.
Before the punt.
What's interesting, though, is that...
For the flag!
Against Houston.
On that last time around, Brennan is open, and it's really an underthrown pass by Bernie Kozar. If he lays that football out there another yard or so, I think Brennan has a completed reception and on his way. He would have made another maybe 5 yards before he's tackled, but that was an underthrown ball by Bernie.
Meanwhile, it's 4th down and 6, so if this penalty is a 5-yarder against Houston, they'll still be short of the first down. And instead, it's a timeout. It's a timeout on Houston is what the call was. Maybe they didn't have enough men on the field. 7-3, Oilers.
He's handling it a little better.
You hear the thunder, the call of the road. No time to wonder, you gotta
leave it to Pontiac to give you the driving experience called Grand Prix. And leave it to Pontiac to guarantee it.
Get on your Pontiac!
Take 30 days after you buy your new 89 Grand Prix to make sure it's the ride of your life. If it isn't, bring it back. Your selling dealer will give you full credit toward another new Pontiac. Grand Prix.
Rebuild excitement.
Guaranteed.
Many financial opportunities offer protection, yet one stands out because it also offers potential for growth. The Travelers Universal Life. Life insurance protection and tax-deferred growth opportunity. So you'll have a special kind of nest egg to secure the financial future of your family or business. Get the Traveler's Universal Life and watch your opportunities grow. The Travelers, you're better off under the umbrella.
Mark and Brian of Rockin' L.A. It's another hot one out there. 98 sweltering degrees and no relief in sight. It's hot, hot, hot.
Right now. The only thing that would taste better than a nice cold one is a cold filtered one.
Man, I sure go for one of these.
Because if you want a beer whose rich, smooth draft taste hasn't been changed by heat pasteurization, we've got it down cold.
Right.
Cold filtered Miller Genuine Draft. It's as real as beer gets.
We have a slightly revised forecast. I say it's cold. Go, go, go.
Houston had taken a timeout. Perhaps for either one too many or one too few men on the field, as Johnson Runniger goes back to punt for Cleveland, so he'll do it again, this time from the 10-yard line. And Johnson is back to receive for Houston at the 35. 13-20 to play, third quarter. Did it again.
Blocked, another Houston block. This time, though, picked up by Fontenot, and Fontenot is out of bounds at the 30-yard line. Johnny Meade blocks the punt. And that's five blocked punts for the Oilers this season, tying an NFL record with six games to go.
The key, though, is that Fontenot is not going to have made it up the first down yardage. But look at that tremendous rush up the middle by the Oilers.
It's the trademark of Jerry Glanville. Wherever he's been, he's had great special teams. The fifth block of a punt for this season, and only in the 10th game. They could shatter the NFL record.
And a good look at Meade's getting his hand on the ball, and Fontenot just comes up a yard short of the first down marker. If Fontenot would have crossed the first down marker, the Browns would have retained possession.
He needed to get to the 31. He gets to only the 30. Oilers get a break, take over at the 30-yard line. Moon gives it to Rozier. And Grayson chases him down after a gain of two. Among the teams holding the record with five block punts, Detroit in 75 and Atlanta in 78. And you talked about the special teams situation and Jerry Glanville's involvement. He was the special teams coach of both of those outfits.
It's his baby. You can see how fired up he gets every time you have a special team come out onto the field.
Second down and seven. Moon and the Oilers at the Cleveland 27. Moon over the middle and wide open. Inside the 10 is Harris.
Uncharacteristically, the Browns sit into a zone defense, and it is read and exploited beautifully by Harris.
And Moon, good read. Leonard Harris, a 20-yard gain. We mentioned before, he would be their number five wide receiver.
And how do you throw it any better? But how can a guy be any more wide open than Harris is on that situation? He just runs a curl about 15 yards downfield, and someone in the Browns secondary just completely went to sleep.
He caught one pass all season. Coming into tonight's game, he's caught two tonight. First and goal, Oilers at the 8. Moon up top again. Chased by Matthews, gets away from him. Throws into the end zone for Givens, touchdown!
Spectacular effort by Moon. About Moon's athletic ability, you saw it there. Boy, would they recognize this up in Edmonton. All the way across the field.
Ernest Givens stays alive, comes all the way across. Felix Wright, you know, picks him up late, but that's just an example that when a quarterback has that much time, Frank, and Moon bought the extra time, someone's going to work their way loose in the end zone.
And give it to Givens. He knew that Moon is the type of quarterback that will keep it alive, and he did.
Zendejas picks the extra point. 12:06 remaining in the third quarter, and the Oilers now lead by 11.
Tots Champagne.
More than just offer you driving excitement, it guarantees it. Get on your pony, I can ride it. Take 30 days after you buy your new Grand Prix to make sure it's the ride of your life. If it isn't, bring it back. Your selling dealer will give you full credit toward another new Pontiac. Grand Prix.
Rebuild excitement.
Guaranteed.
There's finally a little guy that does everything the big guys do. Introducing Minolta's Maxim 3000i, the world's smallest, most affordable autofocus SLR. The first easy little camera that does it all with any lens. And big camera technology in a small body means results that are absolutely incredible. The big little Maxim 3000i.
Only from the mind of Minolta.
It's a shootout between two of the NFL's top guns. Jim Kelly and the front-running Buffalo Bills take on Dan Marino and the Dolphins next week on Monday Night Football.
The Astrodome in Houston, rocking right now. The Oilers leading 14-3. Well, it's funny how the first half ended with the Browns in scoring territory. A sure 3 points, you would think. Possibility of a touchdown, and they open up the second half with a blocked punt and a Houston touchdown.
12:05 remaining in the third quarter, and the deep kick is down in the end zone by Glenn Young.
How important are block kicks in this league? You go back a week ago to the Browns in Cincinnati. Tonight, a quick turnaround with the block punt.
Minifield's blocked last week. Fontenot scoring a touchdown. 17 blocked kicks in the NFL this season, 5 of them by the Oilers.
How about our opening Monday night game, the Giants and the Redskins? Mm-hmm. The Giants end up blocking a Washington kick in that game.
I don't think anything is quite so demoralizing either.
No, it's not. It radiates not only to the special teams, but that goes up and down the bench. That's a real feeling of inadequacy for a football team not to be able to protect your kicker.
Kozar from the 20. And Weathers can't hang on at the 31-yard line. Weathers had a big game against Cincinnati. He was their featured receiver last week with 7 catches, 140 yards, but he's been pretty silent tonight. 2nd and 10. By the way, that touchdown for Houston is the first touchdown the Browns have allowed in the third quarter this season. Coming into this game, Cleveland had given up only 6 points in the third period, 2 field goals.
But the problem. The problem with the Browns, Al, is at the same time they're not scoring any points.
Mm-hmm. Almost every game they've been involved in this season has been low scoring, and tonight no exception. 2nd down 10 from the 20-yard line as Beiner takes it out to the 22-yard line. 3rd down and 8, William Fuller, third year out of North Carolina, in on the tackle.
I would have to assume that everyone who plays defense for the Browns is sitting over on the Brown bench saying, please, guys, please, how about a couple first downs? The Browns offensively have got to get something going after really making a major blunder at the end of the first half. I have to assume that they were looking over their shoulders on their way into the locker room, questioning what went wrong and who made the mistake. Time for them to do a little something constructive.
4 wide receivers in for Cleveland. 3rd and 9 from the 21-yard line. Kozar escapes, then throws back over the middle, and the catch is made by McNeil, the ice cube, at the 39-yard line, and shoots some dice after the first down.
Only the 3rd reception of the year for McNeil, but he's a good receiver. We've seen him in years past. He works well underneath. There he is locked up over on the left side. Defensively for Houston with Langhorne, and he just breaks right underneath. And now, as Kozar is flushed out of the pocket, he moved out to the outside and gave Kozar the angle any good receiver will.
McNeil used to play here in the USFL for the then Houston Gamblers.
It's a tremendous imbalance you're looking at. 14 rushing yards for the Browns.
From the 39-yard line. Kozar going deep and incomplete. Intended for Langhorne, and Brown went right up there with him. Steve Brown.
So much talk about Minifield and Hanford Dixon. Steve Brown and Patrick Allen, the cornerbacks for the Houston Oilers, are fine defensive backs. They're very quiet. You hear very little from them, but they're very effective.
Well, I'm back to my old kick, and that's the line of scrimmage. And right now, the line of scrimmage is being dominated by the Oilers. Bernie Kosar is either being put on his back or being flushed out of the pocket every time he goes back to pass the football. The Cleveland offensive line right now is being pushed backwards.
Boy, Houston is stuffing the running game as they did last week. The Redskins only gained 29 yards on the ground last week against Houston. Second down and 10, and look out, and here they come again. And this time it's Eugene Seale.
They brought everyone but Jerry Glanville on that. Just not enough Browns to pick it up.
Watch Eugene Seale come through from the left. Everyone in the middle is covered off by a defensive lineman. Eugene Seale splits the gap. Boy, that's a well-coordinated blitz. You can see him come right up the middle. Every one of the offensive linemen up front is covered off. The only guy, the center, Paul Ricosi, too late to be able to react.
Three wide receivers and the tight end were in that pattern for Cleveland. They had just, the count just doesn't work. Somebody is going to get in there absolutely free.
Third down and 20 now from the 30-yard line. Here they come again. And Kosar going deep, and breaking off the pattern was Weathers. He ran a sideline route, and Kosar threw deep and missed him by 15 yards, and the Browns will punt before this raucous crowd.
Plain and simple here. This is where the receiver reads one coverage and the quarterback the other. Right there, Weathers reads zone and breaks it off to the outside. Bernie Kosar thought he was locked up man-to-man. Weathers saw the safety coming over, and he broke off his pattern to the sideline.
Max Runiger, and the pressure is on, and this time a good kick. A high, deep kick, fielded at the 20 by Kenny Johnson, and he's tackled by Braggs at the 25. Houston with the ball at the 25, 9:31 to go, third quarter, 14-3.
A little counseling, a little coaching for Weathers by Schottenheimer. Somebody blew that big.
Will your new car outlive your new car loan? Give your engine extra protection and help keep your car running like new longer with STP's new Supra Wear Control, so you'll have something to show for your investment down the road.
What happened when Sony put this color TV and full-featured VCR into this machine? They shrunk. Introducing Sony Video Walkman. It takes video out of your home and into your life.
See this phone? This is my store. And for years, my store was at the mercy of AT&T. But now, with MCI, I finally have an 800 service that charges me only for the actual distance of the calls we get and can tell me where every one of those calls is coming from. And that makes this a better store.
Until you call, you'll never know how much better a long-distance company can be. MCI. Let us show you.
Bring on the city, bring on the night.
If you like to drive, the 89 Grand Prix is a car you're gonna love. Pontiac guarantees it.
Yeah, ride in Pontiac. Get on your Pontiac.
Take 30 days after you buy your new 89 Grand Prix to make sure it's the ride of your life. If it isn't, bring it back. Your selling dealer will give you full credit toward another new Pontiac Grand Prix.
Rebuild excitement.
Guaranteed.
Tomorrow, Election Day, an early look at America's choice at the polls.
Plus all my children's John LeClerc and Kate Collins.
And Leonard Nimoy on Good Morning America.
We haven't seen Drew Hill come back into the game, and we had an earlier report that he had gone out of the game, hit by Felix Wright holding onto the football in a big catch for Houston with a slight concussion. And he's got that sort of goofy look that you and I both know about, Dan.
I don't think we're going to see Drew Hill.
From the 25-yard line, first and 10. Rozier. And a nice gain out to the 34. And again, you think of the Oilers and Moon and those great receivers, but it's been the running game almost silently this year that has been a very, very big part of their success in the line play as well.
Well, a lot of it has to do with, like you say, the line play and the sheer size of this line up front. But look at Rozier break the tackles. Not textbook handling of the football as he goes down. It's almost like he's going into the water and he wants to keep the ball dry, pulling it up in the air, and Rozier comes out hobbled a little bit.
He did. He's had a bad ankle for a long time, and he limps off the field.
Right now it's Steinkuhler, Matthews, Pennison, Munchak, and Davis. They're dominating up front.
Second and one from the 34-yard line. Moon deep. He's got a man open at the 30-yard line. The catch is made by Givens. Givens, and that's about as open as you'll ever see him get because he gets a lot of attention.
Well, the blitz is on. David Grayson comes on the blitz. You can see him from the left and really lower the boom there on Warren Moon, and that single coverage downfield, and Frank Minifield just not able to keep up with Givens. Felix Wright over there way too late, and that's if some cornerbacks, I guess, have to love it, but when you're out there all alone, it's a very dangerous procedure against a guy with Ernest Givens' speed.
Givens crossing underneath Harris. Minifield got all tied up in it, and Givens took it right down the sideline. He was wide open.
Now the Oilers take a timeout.
They do. That's their second. Remember, they took a timeout earlier on the Cleveland punt, so they're down to just one remaining in the game. 7:51 to play in the third quarter.
When it comes to doing business with foreign lands, you gotta know how to balance your trade. You gotta know the time. You gotta know your zones. You gotta know how to speak the language. You gotta bring things in from far away. You gotta know their destinations. Your customers are waiting at the end of the line. Now is no time for complications. This reminder from Federal Express that it's not just a package. It's your business.
Pure, genuine, never heat-pasteurized. A beer that's made unlike any other. Cold-filtered to give you the rich, smooth taste of real draft beer. That's the mark of a great beer. Cold-filtered Miller Genuine Draft. It's as real as it gets.
Yeah.
Harry, Kalamazoo Tuesday, I can do that. Memphis Wednesday, I can do that. New York Thursday, I can do that. How am I going to do that?
No matter where you do business, Northwest can fly you there.
Before you even touch this camera, you're going to want to own it. The incredible 35mm Infinity Super Zoom 300. New from Olympus.
The number two team in the nation, USC, meets Pac-10 rival Arizona State. Or a Big Ten matchup as Michigan State tackles Indiana Saturday on ABC's College Football.
After an Oiler timeout, they have a first and 10 at the Cleveland 27-yard line. Houston on top 14-3. 7:51 remaining in the third quarter. And Glanville asking the crowd to quiet down because they're doing the wave. First and 10 at the 27. Pinkett trips over his own man. Still a good game. Down he goes at the 20-yard line. A pickup of close to 8. Report on Drew Hill, at slight concussion. He will not be back, even though he is still in uniform on the sideline. He has a headache, is the report we get. Carl Hairston, sprained toe. Kevin Mack, we reported earlier, calf injury done for the night.
Again, this is the area they like to bring Pinkett into the ball game. He's very quick, and when it's intense in there, they think the defense is wearing down a little bit. They like to bring him in.
Second down, a long two at the 20.
Mm-hmm. Here comes an audible.
Keep it on the ground. First down, and a lot more for Pinkett. To the 11-yard line.
Boy, and again, look how the guys up front for the Oilers, right now, they are just running roughshod over the Cleveland Browns. And this just is something the Browns aren't used to happening. Look at these guys up front. This will give you a good look at the size of the crease up the middle for Pinkett. Pennison, the center, they just make Golick and Johnson disappear. And, I mean, that's the running back's dream to see those kind of openings up the middle.
They doubled on Golick and drilled him right through Johnson.
First and 10, Houston at the 11. Pinkett again. And wrapped up by Grayson. Dave Grayson, who spotted her, was a defensive back with the Raiders, and he is shaken up on the play.
Must be something about wearing number 56 and coming down the line of scrimmage and catching a play from behind. That's exactly what David Grayson did there, a la Lawrence Taylor. The Browns need something to happen here. And they don't need to sit around and try to make the Oilers, or have the Oilers, make a mistake. Whether it's a blitz, whether it's some sort of a double, triple safety combination coming up, if I'm the Cleveland Browns, I've got to gamble here. I've got to force the Oilers into some sort of an error.
Second and 10 at the 11. There's another changeup. Moon down the line. He takes it to the 3-yard line, and that's something the Oilers do with some frequency, 2-3 times a game. They'll run that option play.
Well, last week, Warren Moon ran the option for a touchdown against the Washington Redskins, took it himself, and came up inside. Here's a good look at it. Warren Moon is going to just take the ball right here and work the line of scrimmage. I mean, that's so simple, but the problem is that Brian Washington misses the tackle. That play doesn't go anywhere for more than a couple of yards, and look at the Browns scramble.
The option was off Michael Dean Perry, and Moon, who automatic to that option, ran it absolutely perfectly. And on a critical play here with third down and two for a first and three for a touchdown, Cleveland has to take a timeout. We're seeing so much of this now with the specialization of offensive situations. The offense runs their specialty players in on a third and long, a third and short, whatever it might be. The defense tries to adjust to it. All of a sudden, you look around, you got the wrong folks out there. You blow a timeout, or you let it go, and you just get beat.
And then you've got Sam White, who figures he's got the way to beat that.
I'll tell you, more and more people are taking a long look at what Sam White has been doing, and he's been scoffed at it over the years, and all of a sudden, it's beginning to seem like the thing to do.
Well, you know, the Bengals will do two different things. They'll actually go with that no-huddle offense, or they'll go with, I guess what they call is their sugar huddle, where they'll only huddle 4 yards off the line of scrimmage and stay in that huddle, and if they see you try to run someone out onto the field, they'll sprint from that huddle and snap the football within 5 or 6 seconds, and you're caught in transition with too many people.
They call it the sugar huddle because it is short and sweet. Night Watch, the season premiere, a gang that's on your side to make the streets safe. And it premieres at 8 Eastern time this Thursday here on ABC, Night Watch. After a Cleveland timeout, it's third down and two for a first, three for a touchdown. And Moon to Rozier. He's in.
Is now total domination along that line of scrimmage. Dan talked about it early on. And once it happens, it almost becomes self-generating, particularly with a team like Houston.
And right now, the Oilers appear to be well on their way to slaying some of their demons. The Cleveland Browns, a hurdle they've not been able to overcome right now, don't seem to be putting up much of a fight against these Houston Oilers, one of the most physical teams in the league, and right now making believers out of a lot of people.
Outside of that strike victory by Houston last year, they have not beaten the Browns since 83. And again, Cleveland in the first 9 games this season had not given up a touchdown in the third quarter. And tonight they yield 2, 21-3.
Talk about those names along that line of scrimmage. You rattled them off a moment ago, Dan, but there are some very impressive people. Stein Cooler, of course, a great All-American out of Nebraska. Bruce Matthews, 74, the brother of Clay Matthews, maybe the best offensive lineman of them all. They just move him around a lot. And Munchak, there are some big names there.
Well, Pennison, the center, is the smallest of the group at 282. Imagine that, how big these guys are getting these days. He's the smallest at 282. The two guards, Matthews and Munchak, are 284 and 293, respectively. And then the tackle, Steinkuhler's 291, and Bruce Davis is 315. Now, when you get bulk like that that can move the way these guys can, no wonder they're running the football effectively.
Your basic physics. Mass, weight, velocity.
Something about the immovable object.
Speaking of Matthews being an extraordinary offensive lineman, we know that his brother, along with Clay's brother, they are watching tonight. His younger brother, Brad, injured in an automobile accident in California and intensive care in L.A. And the Matthews father, Clay Sr., who played for the 49ers a few years ago in the 50s, he's there looking on tonight, and we certainly wish him well.
Yeah, they're all watching this game tonight in the hospital. So, Brad, we're all rooting for you, and needless to say, your two brothers here are as well.
Mm-hmm. Tony Zendejas kicking to the Browns. Fontenot from the 2 out to about the 23-yard line with 4 minutes and 37 seconds remaining in the third quarter. And the Oilers on top now by 18. In this quarter, Houston, 2 touchdowns and 103 total yards. And the Browns limited to 15.
A lot of standing around going on the field right now. The officials are talking about a penalty. There must have been a flag somewhere on the field. I still can't see it. Either one of you guys see a flag out there?
No, sir. Texas State flag.
But it appears that the Oilers are going to have to kick again.
Well, they picked it up, and we'll get the call in a moment from Tom Dooley. Offside. Crazy George.
Oh, we are the greatest! Oh!
Who I believe was the world's first professional cheerleader, the first guy to get paid for losing it.
I think he caught a tourist flight from Indianapolis. He had a few of those last Monday.
I think somewhere along the line related to George the Animal Steel, I believe.
You turn that mic on, it better be on 7-second delay. Yeah.
Well, a very discreet call of a penalty by the officiating staff here. No flags were visible, but one of the Oilers, Kenny Johnson, was offsides, covering the kick. So the Browns, with a dangerous guy like McNeil, Fontenot, and the people they have back there, are going to say, hey, let's do it again.
We get the wide enough shot to watch the way Houston, they have kind of a finesse sort of a kickoff team. They'll bring somebody from the left, and they've been doing it all night. They'll switch him over to the right side, and they look for the kick to carry into the Browns' left corner.
Zendejas now from the 30-yard line.
There they go. That's what they wanted.
Good kick. Fontenot again at the 2. And this time a better run back as he brings it back out to the 33-yard line.
You think special teams aren't wild in the NFL?
Whose flying body was that? Might have been Walter Johnson, a linebacker I saw. Just go flying through the air, or it might have been Spencer Tillman, one of the running backs.
He uttered a Shazam at about the 40-yard line and was airborne.
Cleveland noted for its rushing through the years with Biner and Mack, and of course you go all the way back through the history of that franchise with Achilles and the Browns, and they have not had too many nights like this one.
The Motleys?
Yep. Pruitt, both Pruitts. At the 32-yard line. Kozar. And the pass is caught. Third catch of the night for the tight end, Ozzie Newsome, who was covered on the play by the outside linebacker, Robert Lyles. Ozzie Newsome closing in now on 600 career catches. As we stated before, no tight end in the history of the league has caught more.
But again, we've touched on it, Bernie Kosar knocked flat again just as he was able to deliver the ball.
I'm trying to remember the last time Bernie was still standing at the conclusion of a pass play.
Well, here he is often.
Here he is again immediately after throwing the ball. Ray Childress brings him down.
Second down and one at the 42-yard line. Kozar going deep for Weathers, and it's intercepted by Allen. Patrick Allen gives the ball back to Houston, and is a flag down back at the 33-yard line near where the release was made. And we'll see about Dooley's call.
I think, by the way, the Oilers are acting that this is going to go against Houston. Boy, what a break this would be for the Browns.
Whatever they call, what a great play by Patrick Allen.
Well, it was an underthrown ball. Again, I think that's a pass. If it's laid out there, it's caught.
defensive holding. And so that negates the interception and means an automatic first down as well.
Illegal use of the hands, number 99 defense, first down.
That is Doug Smith, the nose tackle, who says, who, me? You're kidding.
There's Doug Smith on the left, number 99. Let's see if we can catch him somehow illegally using his hands. He's working upfield. You're going to have to do better than that. What was illegal about that? That was nothing more than a straight bull rush up the middle by Doug Smith. I can only assume that they called out the wrong number. That's certainly not an infraction.
No.
I mean, you can't flag him for that. I mean, that's either one of the worst calls of all time or they called the wrong number.
That had to be the wrong number. From the 47-yard line, Kozar for Langhorne. And what a catch by Langhorne. A first down at the 20-yard line as Bird decks Kozar. Langhorne continues into the end zone, but he was down at the 20. So the Browns try to capitalize on that either bogus holding call or a holding call assessed to the wrong guy.
Langhorne against Steve Brown, and then they both go up for it, and a good effort by Langhorne to come down with it.
A pretty catch by Langhorne and a perfect throw by Bernie. But again, Bernie was just hammered as he threw the football. I mean, hatchet chopped right across the head. We'll get a look at it here, and I just have to wonder how long Bernie Kozar is going to be able to withstand this beating.
You know, it's almost worse than a sack because he's totally off balance when he releases the ball. Hard to control the body, hard to control the fall, and he is just getting brutalized.
And down he went on the right elbow as well. Here's a reverse. It's Langhorne taking it from Biner. Langhorne inside the 10 and a touchdown. And so the Browns get a tremendous break on the holding call to negate the interception and then capitalize on a reverse by Langhorne from Biner. He goes in for his fourth touchdown of the season.
And when you get a defense that's all fired up, you know one thing they're going to do. They all want to get into the act. They're all going to pursue, and it's a super call. You give it to Biner, you give it to Langhorne, you've got the defense in a full flow chasing Biner to the left side, and here comes the open field and a great effort by Langhorne to get it in.
They sure look pretty.
Call.
They sure look pretty when they work. But again, we've got to go back to that call against Doug Smith. I mean, if you're a Houston fan, you ought to feel a little bit victimized. I don't know how you explain that.
Unless it was somebody else, as you say. Maybe he said 99 and meant somebody else. Langhorne with a 33-yard reception, followed by a 20-yard touchdown run off the reverse. Barr's extra point is good, and Cleveland gets back into the game with 2:26 to play in the third quarter. 21-10. Houston leading by 11.
As the leader, he's young, but he is the leader of this team, Bernie Kozar.
Well, the onus now falls on the shoulders of the Browns and their defensive team. They've been getting steamrolled. Again, let's go back to that penalty. Number 99 is Doug Smith, the nose tackle. He's working against Greg Roccozzi, the center. Now, he is called for illegal use of hands and holding. Now, I can see his left hand is up in the face. But if that's the case, that's not the proper call. At least I wouldn't think so.
And watching the other linemen, I didn't see any holding in that shot. You can see five of them there.
The only other nine on the field was Patrick Allen, and he was involved deep downfield with the interception.
I guess I can only assume that it was his left hand up in that face mask area that was the reason that penalty was called, but take my word for it, that kind of stuff happens on every single play. It's part of what goes on in the pits.
And it may have turned the game completely around as the kick is fielded by Harris at the 5. And out he comes to the 22-yard line. Stopped by Bragg.
Am I the only one that can hear that?
It's frightening.
2:17 to go, third quarter. The Trojans unbeaten. Rodney Peete coming off a 300-yard performance against Cal, taking on Arizona State. Always tough to win in Tempe, or Michigan State against Indiana, 3:30 Eastern time.
Aren't you supposed
to hold that sword?
Yeah, aren't you supposed to hold it on the handle? I mean, no wonder you.
I can hear him going, ouch, that hurts.
They wouldn't do that in the Big Ten, I'll tell you.
Well, give me a break.
Yeah, me too.
We're looking for you a little later on the year.
Moon hands off to Rozier from the 22, and Rozier takes it out to about the 27-yard line. He is stopped there by Bob Golic. Bob Golic, ninth year in the league out of Notre Dame. Mainstay of a Cleveland defensive unit that has been as good as any in the league much of the season.
Yeah, he talks about the de-evolution of linebacker to nose guard. The Oiler offensive line right now is taking that de-evolution to a whole nother level, a lower level.
Second and three from the 28-yard line. Givens had his hands up in the air as the handoff goes to Rozier. He is stopped at the 30-yard line. Givens was confused at the inception of the play. In fact, he was almost in motion.
Well, if he wasn't confused, he was giving a darn good impersonation of being confused.
I think he was. He just didn't hear the change, and Warren didn't really care because he wasn't involved in it anyway.
And it's a good thing for the Oilers he had come to a complete stop, because had he been in motion with the arms upraised like that at the snap, it would have been an illegal motion penalty. Third down and two instead at the 30-yard line. On a delay, Highsmith for a gain of 13 and a first down to the 43-yard line, tackled by Felix Wright.
And a key tackle by Wright, because Highsmith had an open field in front of him. The blitz was on, and when you pop it on short yardage, you instantly pop into the secondary, and you better get that kind of tackling from your safety man.
And this is an efficient machine up front for Houston. They are picking up stunts. They are picking up blitzes. On that last play, give Bruce Matthews, the right guard, credit. Number 74 there. A brilliant block on the nose tackle, then a blitzing linebacker picks up two. And when you got guys doing that, no wonder they're running so well.
And they're running with great success off time from passing formations. End of the third quarter, 21-10 Oilers. We'll return to the Astrodome after this message about an upcoming show on ABC and a word from your local station.
In 6 days.
Here we go!
The most monumental achievement in television history. Herman Wouk's War and Remembrance, starting Sunday. They've got a healthy appetite for the opposite sex.
Devour him.
But one's also got a taste for murder. Lady Killers, Wednesday. It's time we had a Supreme Court judge who'll stand up for the people of Texas. For 10 years in the Texas Senate, he fought the power brokers to protect the rights of people. Lloyd Doggett. He wrote one of the toughest consumer laws in the nation. Lloyd Doggett. Now he's leading the fight for court reform to make judges more accountable. The Dallas Times-Herald said it best, a tough-minded independent with a devotion to fairness. Lloyd Doggett, nobody's man but his own. He'll be nobody's judge but yours.
Whether you work up a man-sized thirst or a man-sized thirst, nothing tackles it like Diet Coke. The real cola taste you can drink more of, cause it's just one calorie.
I'll flip you for it.
Heads again.
Just for the taste of it, Diet Coke.
KTRE-TV, the East Texas station.
We start the fourth quarter at the Astrodome in Houston. Al Michaels, Frank Gifford, and Dan Dierdorf. The Oilers have the ball and the lead, 21-10. Houston at its own 43-yard line, first and 10. Warren Moon, the quarterback. This is Pinkett, who breaks a tackle in the backfield and takes it out to the 50-yard line. Gain of 7.
Boy, the Browns are having trouble making a play even when they're in a position to do so. That time Pinkett eludes a tackler deep in the backfield and still gets away and makes a play. Darrell Sims, I think, was the defensive end that wasn't able to corral Pinkett in the backfield. And everything seems to be rolling right for the Oilers here in the second half. They're making it roll their way.
Second and three from the 50. Cornerbacks come up. Dixon to Minifield, and they change it off. Make it again, and look at him tunnel his way through for a first down to the Cleveland 44.
I'll give a lot of credit to Moon tonight. He has worked this offensive unit. He's getting a great effort by the offensive line, but he has worked it well, too. He saw Minifield. He saw Dixon come up, probably indicating there was going to be a blitz. Knows that this is very effective against it, just straight zone blocking, and they've been overpowering at the line of scrimmage. They get the hole, give it to the little quick man, 5'9", 192-pounder from Notre Dame. You get the first down. Good effort by Moon.
Very much the way Glanville had hoped things would work out. He said a lot of Rozier early, then he'll get a little tired. We'll bring in the fresh Pinkett. We'll spot Highsmith from time to time. Exactly as drawn up. Here's Pinkett again, and this time nothing doing as Clay Matthews, the former Trojan, in his 11th year, comes into the backfield. Yeah, right.
Yeah. Al, you talk about the way that Jerry Glanville can work his running backs. He's got so many that at the same time he can afford to make a project out of Lorenzo White. I mean, he's not even going to subject Lorenzo White to game conditions until he feels he's ready. And how many people have the luxury to do that with their number one draft choice? How many people have that much depth?
What do they do, call them Bula Bula backs?
Yep.
The old Yale fight song. Lorenzo White is a rookie out of Michigan State that gained over 4,500 yards. Now, does he not get any respect?
Well, he just thinks he's an incomplete back, that all he ever did was run the football, never had to block, never had to pick up blitzes.
Second and 13. The catch is made at the 42-yard line by Leonard Harris. And again, Harris is the fellow who came into the game with one catch all season, and that's three tonight for him. And we talk about how deep they are in the backfield with their running backs. Look at their receivers as well. And there is White, number 44, who hasn't played tonight. He is the number four running back in effect. And as far as receivers are concerned, they have Hill and Givens and Curtis Duncan and Willie Drury, who would be one through four. And then the fifth back, Harris, has been a key factor tonight. Third and eight from the 42-yard line from the shotgun. Good protection. Moon goes deep for Givens. It's tipped and incomplete. Underthrown, tipped away by Brian Washington, the rookie out of Nebraska.
What did Warren Moon tell us? His shoulder still does not allow him to put the trajectory on the ball. He said it doesn't hurt actually all the time, but he says, I just can't do certain things. One of them is to lay it up, and this, you can see how flat it was. We can't see it on this shot, but that ball never got more than 25, 30 feet off the ground.
Yeah, he said he can't put the arch on the ball. What Warren Moon has is a bursa sac up in his shoulder that rubs against his shoulder joint, and he said the thing that prohibits me the most from doing is up over the top with that over-the-top throwing motion. And that's where it comes into play on a long pass like that.
And it may eventually require surgery. Montgomery to kick. Angles it to the far side, and it bounces out of bounds at the 14-yard line. 11:42 remaining, fourth quarter. Houston ahead by 11.
Said that form should always follow function. But on rare occasions, the function is already so highly advanced that the form is free to pursue absolute beauty. Presenting the Mercedes-Benz 300 CE Coupe.
Daybreak at your morning place, all over the land. Fresh hot way to start your day. Get your boogie in along and on your way. A good time, a great taste. Breakfast at my morning place.
A good time, great taste
of McDonald's.
Good time, great taste.
Breakfast at our morning place.
A good time, great taste.
Yeah.
Of McDonald's.
If you thought you had to give up comfort to get a close shave, Norelco says, think again. Their revolutionary system way that's incredibly comfortable. As the hair enters the chamber, the patented lift and cut system lifts each hair and holds it a split second before a blade cuts it, so it's possible to shave skin close without the blades even touching the skin. The lift and cut shaving system from Norelco. We made close comfortable.
Jim Kelly and the Buffalo Bills are trying to run away with the AFC East, but the Miami Dolphins are out to narrow that lead. Next week on ABC's Monday Night Football.
They call Wrigley Field the friendly confines. They haven't seen this booth, huh?
This is a little narrow, isn't it?
I would say.
I don't help matters any.
Not a whole lot of room for you and your appliances.
They said it's going to be a physical game tonight. We didn't know it was going to be quite this physical.
21-10 is the score, and the Oilers in a very big game.
It's a good
leading
example.
By 11. They
good
can't
example.
Even turn around. Little hardware here.
We are in here amongst the gizmos.
Well, a big drive right now for the Cleveland Browns as they begin at their 13-yard line, and Kozar slings one to Langhorne, and they begin with a first down out to the 28. Winner of this game in second place, a game back of Cincinnati. The loser, two games back.
Hey, when you're coming across the middle and you're a receiver, you don't mind one like that. What you don't want is that one you hang up a little high and you got to go up and get it.
Yeah, let's go over and poll Drew Hill and see if he won't agree with you.
Well, Langhorne was the key man on that last drive, and they call his number again. First and 10 at the 28-yard line. Kozar deep down the left sideline, intended for Gerald McNeil. Covered by Allen. Kozar was pressured, having to throw in a hurry, and a second down and 10.
Nine men on the line of scrimmage then. Kozar read it, just tried to hang it up. Here they come. Five-man rushes. We got the linebackers dropping out, but you do get individual coverage, and Kozar read that. All right. Just didn't have time to get it there.
I am not surprised, because I've seen it before, but I admire the courage of the Oilers and their defensive staff. They are relentless, and they're coming after you with blitzes and line stunts. They just really get after it on every single down.
Second and 10 from the 28-yard line. Kozar, incomplete, way underthrown. Weathers was in the neighborhood, but really not that close.
But again, they got into Kozar, flushed him out of the pocket. He had to throw that ball away.
Of course, they did that with only a four-man rush. They got up in the middle with two linebackers, showed the blitz. They drop out, and still they're effective with only four people at that time chasing Bernie out of the pocket.
Third and 10, Cleveland from the 28-yard line, 10:50 remaining, fourth quarter.
These two teams will meet again December the 18th in Cleveland. They'll be in their mufti that day.
Outdoors, on grass.
On the lake.
Third and 10 from the shotgun. Kozar pressured again. Escapes, throws, tip, incomplete. Nearly picked off, intended for Biner. Fourth down. Covered by Lyle.
Pressure again. They are just relentless. Those are, again, a good enough coverage downfield, but he couldn't get it off. Tried to shoot it into Viner, and they were all over him.
Max Runiger's punt. Short kick. Drop. At the 41, Cleveland has it. Kenny Johnson fumbles it as he tried to catch it on the run, and the Browns get a tremendous break. They have the ball back at the 41 with 10 and a half minutes to play.
Well, that's a mistake by Johnson.
That ball was not kicked as deep as Johnson thought it was going to be, and Kenny Johnson, rather than going ahead and letting it bounce and taking a chance, charges the ball and tries to make a play. Again, I think that's that aggressive psyche of the Houston Oilers. If there's an opportunity to lay back or an opportunity to charge and make the play, I think their motto is charge and try to make the play.
It's a full go for it. Earlier, we saw Kenny Johnson make a spectacular play on a punt to save the ball from going deep into his own territory. This one he tried to steal for a long run back, paid the price. The Browns have good field position.
Cleveland at the Houston 40-yard line. Beiner in motion. Kozar on a roll and under pressure and has to throw it away. And that time the pressure from number 93, Robert Lyles, the man who nicknamed this place the House of Pain.
Well, Bernie's just going to run a bootleg, and this is a naked bootleg all the way. And when Robert Lyles has a defense call that allows him to go upfield, that's a dead play. And Bernie Kozar is just fortunate that he got out of that, not so much with the incompletion, that he got out of it without tearing up his knee. Because Lyles is right there into his leg. And this is the self-styled House of Pain. Robert Lyles, a martial artist, has done some work along those lines and named it after a place where he works out.
Second and 10, and Beiner has a nice hole to exploit and does so for a first down, or close to it, at the 30-yard line. Let's see where they spot the ball. They had to get to the 30 and a half. And they put it down at the 30-yard line.
And one of those rare opportunities, Al, that a Cleveland running back has seen anything that even resembles a hole big enough to get through and get into the secondary.
And again, worth noting, Houston not only pressuring Doug Williams last week, but stuffing the entire Washington running game as well. A first down here, and tonight holding the Cleveland running game very much in check, at least to this point. A reminder tonight on Nightline. In a matter of hours, the voters will have their say. Tonight, ABC News correspondents and analysts will wrap up Nightline's Campaign 88 coverage in a one-hour Election Eve edition. Tonight on Nightline.
Well, we said it before tonight, but get out and vote tomorrow. Dan is right. If you don't vote, you got no reason to complain. So go do it.
First and 10 at the 30. Kozar. He's got Newsom open, and he hits him at the 5-yard line.
A second spectacular play tonight on the part of Ozzie Newsom. And again, pressure on Kozar, but he was up to it, getting the ball, even though it was low, to Newsom, who makes a spectacular catch.
Bernie was forced to throw off of his heels, and what a study and concentration by Ozzie Newsom sliding in to make that catch. This time the pressure wasn't so much up the middle. It was more perceived than anything else by Kozar. But boy, what a throw and what a reaction to that short and outside ball by Ozzie Newsom.
And Newsom must be surprised, as the Browns must be. He was being covered by Lyles, the linebacker.
Oh, you think the Browns are surprised? How about the Oilers? They're about to find the Browns right back in this game.
First and goal, draw to Beiner, looks for room and picks up two, gets to the 3. Stopped there by Meads with under 9 minutes to play.
Remember those numbers we showed you earlier about the Oilers defense? Their goal line defense, has been the worst in the league.
But you know what? Right after we showed those numbers, yep, they didn't let the Browns get in. Partly through the Browns' own mistakes and not at least having enough time left on the clock to kick a field goal. To refresh your memories, the Oilers had allowed every team so far this year that had a first and goal situation to score a touchdown until that last series of the first half.
Second and goal from the 4. Beiner again, nothing doing. Minimal gain. It's Robert Lyles with the initial hit. Third down and goal from the 4. The Browns on first and goal. And that's very interesting because the Oilers had not stopped anybody. It would figure they would stop Cleveland because Cleveland has been the worst in the league through 9 weeks. First and goal. Getting it in only 4 times out of 10.
When you match those two numbers together, who gets the credit, who gets the blame?
Steve Hurt. Paul Vegas immediately. Third and goal from the 4. Kozar pump fakes, throws, open is Newsome, touchdown. And so the Cleveland Browns, with an extra point here, would be within four.
They tried to cover Newsome once again with Robert Lyles, the linebacker.
Well, Robert Lyles had time, just went to sleep. He got confused in his coverage because he's locked up all the way with Ozzie Newsome. Look at Newsome right here. Here's Lyles, but watch Newsome just release, and Lyles falls off and then is very late trying to get back out in his coverage. Now look, right there, he's locked up with Newsome, and he lets him go. He looks back to the inside and then tries to react, and Lyles, I don't know, he had a brain lapse there for a minute.
Tried to help out on the inside. That's the first thing they tell you. Take care of your own job, your own coverage, and then provide the help.
That Favre's extra point is good. So Cleveland, very opportunistic, capitalizing on the Johnson fumble, taking it in for the touchdown. 21-17.
It's a Radio Shack Merry Christmas.
This Christmas, I'm going to make sure my children stay in touch all year. I gave each of them Radio Shack sale price one-piece mini-phone. Trim, design, and it comes with a 13-foot cord, a mute button, and a convenient redial button. And best of all, it was on sale for only $12.95. I even bought one for myself. You think they'll get the hint? Hello? My son, what a surprise!
The mini-phone, on sale for $12.95, only at Radio Shack.
Once again, the automotive world is focusing on Mercedes-Benz because the engineers who created the 190 class and a whole new automotive category have just recreated it.
Give me 2,000 watts, sir.
Introducing the Mercedes-Benz 190 class, the second generation.
Thing that would taste better than a nice cold one is a cold filter one.
Can you draft anyone?
Thanks. Not the time.
Because if you want a beer whose rich, smooth draft taste hasn't been changed by heat pasteurization, we've got it down cold. Cold filtered, more genuine draft. It's as real as beer gets.
The number two team in the nation, USC, meets Pac-10 rival Arizona State. Or a Big Ten matchup as Michigan State tackles Indiana Saturday on ABC's College Football.
So Cleveland, extremely opportunistic. When they were down 21-3, instead of an interception, a holding penalty kept the drive alive. They took advantage of that to score a touchdown. Then the fumble by Johnson on the punt return, they take advantage of that to score a touchdown. And they're back in it, down by four with a lot of time left, 7:26. Barr to kick off. After the Newsome touchdown, Ozzie's fifth catch of the night. This is Leonard Harris out to the 19-yard line. So this has been a memorable night for Ozzie Newsome, who talks about his most memorable moment in football.
My most memorable moment was in the very first game in the National Football League against the 49ers. On an end around, the very first time I touched the ball, I scored about a 35-yard touchdown. It was a great way to break in.
Could well have been when Bear Bryant called him the best football player ever had played for him.
That was a milestone catch, by the way, that touchdown grab by Newsome, his 600th career catch. Rozier back out to the 24-yard line. There it is, and everybody else would be a wide receiver, headed by Steve Largent, who goes on and on. Joyner and Charlie Taylor and Don Maynard and New England coach Raymond Berry. And there's Ozzie, the tight end, all alone at 600, number six on the all-time list.
And he's all alone as far as tight ends are concerned. I'm not looking at the numbers, but I believe Jackie Smith was the tight end reception leader before Ozzie Newsome passed him. And that was a long time ago, a couple hundred receptions ago.
Mm-hmm. And Mike Ditka was resting comfortably, set a record for tight ends back when he was playing. We understand he's in fair condition.
Here's Rozier.
Stop for no gain. We understand Mike may get out of the hospital. They're going to run a stress test on him in a couple of days.
Knowing Mike, look out, treadmill.
But I guess their latest statement says that the earliest that Mike Ditka could be back at the helm of the Bears would be early December, and that's very inconsequential right now when he's back in control of the Bears. His spirit is still in control, but right now, goal number one, get healthy, get well.
Absolutely. Had to make Mike feel awfully good. All the affection and concern that was poured out over the past several days for Mike Ditka.
Third and five out of the shotgun from the 25-yard line. Under 6 minutes to go. Moon handles the low snap. Looking for a first down, but he is run out of bounds at the 26-yard line, well shy of it by Mike Johnson.
And what kind of coverage did the Browns have that time in the secondary? Because they had no pass rush whatsoever. Warren Moon doesn't even have to leave the pocket until he's back there for about 4 or 5 seconds, and then he's forced to scramble and gets nothing. Let's take a good look here at what's happening back in the Browns secondary. Look at the pass rush. There's none even there. Moon leaves on his own, still wants to throw it, can't get rid of it, and Mike Johnson gets over there and runs him out of bounds. Credit that one to the guys in the secondary for the Browns.
The rookie punter, Greg Montgomery, to kick it away, end over end, a low kick. McNeil backs up, there's a flag down. McNeil at the 33 is tackled at the 36-yard line. And a marker on the far side at the line of scrimmage.
And this, if this penalty should go against the Browns at all, the yardage is sufficient to give a first down. But no, this is against Houston.
Illegal man downfield.
And with a short kick like that,
illegal man downfield.
You would think the Browns would take the ball.
Thank you.
Leo Miles, the head linesman, stepping in there, a former teammate of mine, picking up the illegal man.
.532 remaining in the game. Here's Dooley.
Disregard the flag. There is no foul. 28 was a man on the end of the line. What's that?
All right, he was legal then.
Okay.
Good field position now for the Cleveland Browns.
They'll start from the 36 when we come back.
Tuesday is an important day. Your decision is not so much about the candidates, it's about you. Do you really want to risk going back to high interest rates, high inflation, higher taxes, and higher unemployment? Do you want to go back to the days of military weakness, caring more about criminals than victims? We can't risk that. If you agree with me that we must keep America working and the economy growing, I'd like your vote on Tuesday.
Only one place for that original taste.
Only one place, only one taste. That's original.
Kentucky Fried Chicken.
What a taste.
Kentucky Fried Chicken.
That's the place.
Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Kentucky Fried Chicken.
The original recipe.
Oh, what a taste.
Kentucky Fried Chicken.
We do chicken right.
Mercedes-Benz 560 SL Coupe Roadster. Is it the car you wanted above all others because of its mighty V8 power? Or its blend of quick reflexes and sumptuous comfort? Or its incredible workmanship and finish? Only one thing is certain. You will have the driving experience of your life finding out.
Well, you'd have to go back almost 22 years. The Browns trailing in a game by 18 points or more. They trailed the Giants and then beat them 49-40 in December of 1966. And they're attempting that same sort of comeback tonight. They trailed here 21-3, but have driven for two touchdowns and have the ball now at their own 36-yard line, first and 10. 5:32 to play. Kozar too high, intended for Brennan, covered by Brown. Second down and 10. And just to refresh you, the Oilers have one timeout remaining. The Browns have two timeouts remaining as we get down toward the end.
And when you can, the way the Oilers have really dominated this game,
here in the second half. To think that they are clinging to a four-point lead has to be a little sobering there to Jerry Glanville. I mean, I'm sure that the way things have been going for him, if you would have asked him how things were going to be with 5 minutes left in the game, he would have thought he would have had this one nicely tucked away.
And it's quite a tribute to this Cleveland Brown team. They could have packed up and headed for the airplane.
Second down and 10 from the 36-yard line. Kozar, high throw. And it was number 23, Richard Johnson, taking it away from McNeil.
Put that one in your training film.
McNeil only weighs 147 pounds, and when you get a chance to go after him, Richard Johnson really slam dunked him.
Well, the ball was thrown up in the air, and it forces McNeil to leave his feet to go up and get it. Of course, almost any pass forces Gerald McNeil to do that, and Johnson,
he's
must have been a little surprised how light McNeil was. That was a slam dunk. That was a Darryl Dawkins job all the way to the ground.
3 points on that takedown. Third down and 10. From the 36-yard line. Kozar to Biner, but he's well short of the first down. He stretches and reaches and can only get it to the 43-yard line. So he comes up about 3 yards shy. He is stopped by Lyles. The clock ticking down to the 5-minute mark, and the Browns will have to punt to Houston.
And now it's the Houston defense to come back.
That's right. I said last time, give the Browns credit for their coverage. Well, exactly the same scenario there for the Oilers. No one open at all downfield, and they'll willingly give up that short dump off to Biner that they know isn't going to get a first down.
Max Runiger, who began the year with the 49ers and was cut and signed by Cleveland to boot it away. Fair catch call for this time by Johnson, whose fumble led to Cleveland's last touchdown. He makes the fair catch at the 22, and the Oilers have the ball with 4 minutes and 31 seconds remaining.
I don't know whether you noticed, but a lot of nervous Browns along that line of scrimmage on that punting team after having the punt blocked earlier. They almost could have flagged a couple of them. Warren Moon, and he has something in common with you, Al. Of course, I'm sure you're aware of it. You're a fellow alumnus from Hamilton High School.
Absolutely.
Hamilton High School Yankees.
In
different years, of course.
Slightly different, yeah.
The Houston Oilers Travelers Man of the Year. And once again, for service to your community off the field, and the Travelers Man of the Year in the NFL will be announced on Super Bowl Day.
How can a high school in Los Angeles be nicknamed the Yankees?
Well, Al's from Brooklyn.
Good question. Rozier, and Rozier loses the football, but after the play had been whistled dead out at the 25-yard line.
Got that Yankee label with you, didn't you?
Absolutely.
You know, this is the type of situation where all those Oiler linemen looking at each other in a huddle say, guys, all we have to do is keep it going. Nothing simple, nothing fancy here, rather. Mike Rozier taking it off right tackle. Another nice hole.
You know, you think you'd be tempted to...
Where does the ball come out?
Tempted to squeeze that ball in there a little bit.
Well, I
progress
guess the official ruling, yeah, the forward progress came to an end before they peeled the ball out of there.
Hey, he does carry it a little cavalierly.
Second down and 6 from the 25-yard line, and this is Rozier, and he gets stuffed for a loss of 2. Back to the 23, Dave Grayson makes the tackle.
You know, it's just not a coincidence that the Browns keep winning the AFC Central year in and year out. I mean, this is a championship caliber team that doesn't rattle in important football games. And even though that they have been manhandled, and there's really no other way to describe the way the Oilers have pushed them around here in the second half, this is the type of situation that they normally rise to.
Third and 8 from the 23.
Three wide receivers to the bottom here.
And 4 in the field. Moon on a short roll to the left. Looking over the middle. Going deep. And a fingertip reaching catch made by Leonard Harris.
Oh, there was great coverage on that. It was a great catch, but Warren Moon put it in the only place where it would have been a completion.
And he was talking about the fact he was having trouble arcing the football, but that time, perfect. And a critical and vital first down for Houston.
And perfect is the only way to describe it. Mark Harper is the Cleveland Brown that's trying to have the coverage on Leonard Harris. But what a beautiful, I mean, just beautiful pass. Brian Washington, the safety, plays it a little short, Frank. Washington's play as a safety has to be a little deeper than that. But some kind of play by Moon and the Oilers.
Harris, who was signed by Houston during the strike last year and has earned a spot, and what a spot. And what a performance tonight. And that was a very big play. And again, with the Browns down to two timeouts, Houston has the ball. We're down to the two-minute warning. It'll be second and 11 when we come back at the 36-yard line. The Oilers remain on top, 21-17.
Sometimes the best way to avoid the rush is to simply slow down.
You gotta stop and face the high line. Stop, make some time, find enough. What you're working for, what it's all about.
Miller High Life, brewed to be smooth, never bitter, takes time to make, time to enjoy.
Stop and taste the high life.
Miller High Life.
Sometimes I don't know what to believe, what food's good for you, what's not. But I guess I can believe reports from the National Cancer Institute. They say some studies suggest a high-fiber, low-fat diet may reduce the risk of some kinds of cancer. So I made some changes.
Like eating Kellogg's All Bran. Just one tablespoon of All Bran has more fiber than a whole serving of most other cereals.
Am I going to change what I eat for breakfast? You better believe it.
High-fiber Kellogg's All Bran.
It happens every 7 seconds. Every 7 seconds of every hour of every business day, America puts another new Epson computer or printer to work. It's true. When you've got an Epson, you've got a lot of company.
You'll never see it any better. The ball perfectly thrown, or it would have been deflected. And then Leonard Harris, who came into tonight with one reception, comes down with a spectacular catch, and this is the way he was greeted.
When you need a first down, pretty dramatic way to go about getting it by Leonard Harris and the Houston Oilers and Warren Moon.
Last year during the strike, he caught six passes in the game against the Browns. So he's tough against the real Browns or the fake Browns. Second and 11, and the catch made by Givens, and Givens takes it to the 29-yard line. And Cleveland has to take a timeout. And remember, they took one earlier, so they will now be down to one. There it is. They make the change on the scoreboard. They are down to one. Cleveland, and the problem had been early on this season, if they'd had any problem defensively, the lack of sacks. They picked up Buchanan. He made a big difference. They had 19 in the last three games, but Buchanan has been silent tonight, and the Browns defense without a sack tonight.
And you've already talked about the troubles that Zendejas has had in the field goal department out. I'm sure they would like to get this little baby in a little closer. Well, get it all the way in if they can.
This game is over if Houston picks up a first down on this play, because Cleveland could stop the clock only once. And so on a third and five, here's the critical play for the Cleveland defense.
And there's the Cleveland offense just hoping they get a chance to get back out on the field when it means something. Of course, should the Browns get the football back, keep in mind they're down by 4 points if Houston doesn't score. If they would have kicked a field goal at the end of the first half, they're only down by one and a field goal would win it.
That's right, and they let the clock run out and they had a timeout and couldn't get to it. They run a draw, and that's nothing. Highsmith stopped at the 30, and the Browns will spend their final timeout. So this is their last timeout. It's fourth down. We will see Zendejas come in to attempt a 47-yard field goal, and then the Browns will have to go the length of the field without a timeout.
And score a touchdown.
Mm-hmm.
A touchdown to tie it if, say, Zendejas converts. A touchdown to win it if he misses. But again,
I hearken back to that missed field goal. I mean, the botched series that never even resulted in a field goal attempt. The Browns right now really should be trailing only 21-20.
You saw his numbers there from 40 through 49. Outside 40, his total 3 for 10. Earlier in the season, Greg Montgomery was holding for Tony Zendejas. He was not terribly happy with that. Brent Pease, the backup quarterback, was on the inactive list. But this will be Brent Pease, and Zendejas has had the most success with him.
47-yard attempt. Earlier, he was short from 52. This time, he's perfect from 47.
Feels good when you're struggling as a kicker. Dramatic way to settle it.
Thus, the Browns will have to take the ball, go in for a touchdown, and convert to send the game into overtime. And they'll have to do that without a timeout and a minute 44 on the clock.
And you'd have to think that one of the ways to get it started would be some sort of a decent kickoff return. Of course, the Oilers know that, and I would imagine that Zendejas is going to, in some way, squib kick or power kick the football down the field, bouncing it downfield, trying to keep the Browns from setting up a return.
You know, we talked about the holder, Pease, that time. That was a high snap, and that is very unnerving to a kicker. And it was perfectly placed, obviously, because you get it through. And there is the young quarterback who is back holding the ball for Tony Zendejas. And kickers are that way. They get caught up with the holder, and nobody else can do it the same way for them.
If the Oilers should hold on and win this football game, we talked about it early, that the House of Pain, the goblins of the Houston Oilers, really don't mean a whole lot unless they can prove that they can beat the defending champion, and that is the Cleveland Browns. And they have to go to Cleveland the last game of the season. Not the most hospitable place to be in Cleveland Stadium in the end of December, and the Oilers are well aware of that. They knew this was a game they had to beat the Cleveland Browns here in their own backyard.
Oilers have not beaten the Browns twice in a season since 1978. Well, they felt the road to the Central Division title would go through Cleveland. They didn't figure it would have to go through Cincinnati as well. Taking them one at a time is Zendejas. Kicks to the 2-yard line. Glenn Young brings it back out to the 27. So they have to go 73 yards in a minute 38 with no timeouts and kick the extra point to tie the game.
Before Houston gets to Cleveland, they are going to have to go to Seattle, then Phoenix, Dallas, Pittsburgh, Cincinnati, and then their finale.
You know, this is a situation, guys, where Bernie Kosar really misses Webster Slaughter. Webster Slaughter, the Browns' best wide receiver, is out and not available, and this is the type of situation with his explosiveness, you'd think that he'd be the guy that Bernie Kosar might lean towards going through.
You know, you don't have much time, 1:38. Kick with no timeouts, but what they will give you is the middle, and it's not a bad idea to take a big one in the middle if you can get it.
Four receivers, two to each side, over the middle. He hits McNeil. He makes the catch at the 45-yard line. That's a first down, and there's an injured Brown. That's Langhorn down at the 43-yard line, but the clock keeps on moving. They can't stop it. Langhorn gets up.
Kosar went up to him and said, "Get on your feet." The play has already been called in the huddle.
Yeah, he said, "You're not coached by Buddy Ryan. Get up." Kosar throws, and that's incomplete at the 45-yard line. Second and 10. Pressure again on Kosar. Second down.
Take a look at Gerald McNeil here. Look how he gets knocked to the ground. And then at the conclusion of the play, he goes up for it. That's a pretty gutsy play by McNeil, staying with it.
He does get buffeted around out there, doesn't he?
He does. It doesn't take much to knock him to the ground. But give him credit. He comes back up and fights.
Again, they'll give you the big stuff up the middle. Nothing easy on the sideline. Uh-oh.
Aaron snap. Kosar, loose ball. Houston recovers.
And it's Ray Childress, who tied the record last week with three fumble recoveries. He recovers his seventh fumble of the year.
And that snap by Greg Roccozzi was way offline. It was high and outside. A wild pitch by Roccozzi. That ball was not only high, but way off to Bernie Kosar's right side,
who has not been working out of the shotgun until just the coming back from the injury.
A good look at it there. Look how far to the right that ball is.
He's 6'5". Terrible snap.
And Ray Childress right there before Cody Risen can get to the football. And ooh. Second-year player out of Miami, their number two draft choice last year, and that's a horrible feeling.
And only recently, as we mentioned before, have the Browns gone back to the shotgun. Houston can run the clock out now. Cleveland can't do a thing. Oilers will only have to run one more play. And Glanville's team will be 7-3. They'll be a game back in the Central Division. Again, if the season stopped tonight, Cleveland would be in as a wild card. Houston would be in as a wild card as well.
And a study
for the minute standing.
And a study of these two quarterbacks tonight. Bernie Kosar, who has never lost to the Houston Oilers, and Warren Moon, who has never defeated the Cleveland Browns. Demons be gone.
And they've had a little bit more success than the last Demons Be Gone we knew, who was the favorite in the Kentucky Derby last year. Broke down on the backstretch, but not the Oilers tonight.
Hey, Daddy, you're doing all right. They bring their kids out to practice every Saturday. Togetherness, this man believes in it, and it paid off big tonight.
The Oilers. Glanville is a little difference in the way Jerry leaves the field after the game as opposed to the way he went to the exits after the first half.
And a good shot there of him hugging the father on the way out. That is a
seats for him, 50-yard line. He said, no thanks. I'm going to prepare
for
the election results.
Right.
Oilers already, though, 1.5-point underdogs against Seattle on Sunday. Channel 2 will have it for you at 3 o'clock. Of course, ABC had last night's game, but I think our pictures tell the story. Well, as the half ended, Jerry Glanville, you might have seen, really got steamed. The audience, maybe you're still wondering what happened. Jerry ran after the officials as time ran out.